innocent! You're the murderers! Daly, Ronan, Young, you should be on this chair!
Hey, this is Otacon, and you're listening to the Codec.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with you live for episode 28 of the Codec, our interview with Christopher Randolph. Good afternoon, sir. How are you doing?
I am fine, thank you. Good to see you guys again.
You too. Good. We're to excited to have you. We've got our two co-hosts here, Young. Yeah.
What's up, everybody? It's Young here, and welcome to another episode of the Codec. We got Christopher Randolph again. This time, we're going to talk about Huey. We're going to talk about a bunch of things. We're so excited to have you back. The game's finally out, and we got a lot to talk about. So stay tuned, folks.
Definitely.
Right, and Corrupt Ronan.
What is up, ladies and gentlemen? Corrupt Ronan here. Pleasure to be back on the show again. Like I said before, the week that I was out prior to, there were some personal issues going on, but most of those have been resolved for the most part. And thank you, Christopher, for joining us once again. This is the third time we've had you on the show, and it's always a pleasure to have you here.
Sure, it's my pleasure. I'm happy to be here.
Awesome.
Okay, so Young is going to start off our questions for today. So Young, sure. Take it away.
Sure. Well, first of all, again, thank you for joining us. And now that Phantom Pain is finally out, how do you feel? How has that been like since?
Oh, well, it's been great. The response to the game has been extraordinary. At least everything that I've seen has been pretty much remarkable. And I'm very, very proud of the work. I'm a little nostalgic that this is probably the end of the Metal Gear, at least this cycle of it, and it'll be quite a while until another, you know, some other version of it comes out. But and it could well be the end. So I'm a little sad about that, but yeah. I'm very proud of the work that we did.
Yeah, we're also very sad and melancholic about that situation. But you know, we'll see what happens, right? You never know what the future holds. And for the people who may not know who you are, who may be coming on to our show for the first time, just tell us a bit about yourself. Who's Christopher Randolph? And tell us a bit about the work that you do.
Sure. I'm an actor and a director. And, I've been playing the role of Otacon and more recently his father, Huey, in the Metal Gear series since 1998, I think, was when we got started. And that's really why I'm here. But I do all different kinds of acting, stage, voice acting, and film and television when I can do it. And I recently have been directing a lot for the stage. So,
cool. What's your latest work, if I may ask?
Well, right now I'm sort of in a lull. I directed two plays this past summer, one in New York and one in Boston. And actually, it looks like we're going to do the Boston one again next spring in Boston.
Wow. Very cool. Well, nice. What are the plays?
The Boston play is a really interesting new play called Eyes Shut, Door Open, by a young Boston playwright. And it's kind of a very exciting three character play about two brothers and the reunited after a long time, and there's a woman in the mix, and it's one of those plays where it ends up with the apartment trashed and blood on the floor and
it's
a lot of fun.
a lot of fun, he says.
So I'm it looks like we're gonna have a chance to do that one again. And then the other one I directed this summer was a remount of something I had directed before. Very interesting play about the genocide in Srebrenica and Kosovo in 1995. A cheery subject, but a very good play that I think deserves a further life. So we're still working on that as well to see if we can get it out to other people too.
Hopefully, I can go and watch one of the plays you direct because they both sound very interesting.
I would love that. To see. I would love to have you there. I'd love to know what you think
about. You're not that far, are you?
Young. Where are you, Young? I don't even.
I'm
know.
In Delaware. I can drive to like New York.
You could make it up to New York, certainly.
Right. Yeah, well, keep me updated on your plays. I'll definitely. Yeah. I love theater, so I would love to come see one.
That'd be awesome. I'm gonna take a trip from Florida one day.
Seriously, quite, I need to.
It's quite a big quite a bigger distance, but awesome. So Ronan, I think you're up next, bud.
Awesome. Well, Chris, first of all, I want to congratulate you on your fantastic performance as Huey in the game. It was a phenomenal job on that.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
And second of all, do you think that Huey, looking back at your performance as Huey, do you think that, you know, even though Huey's story is concluded, do you think that they gave, you know, a certain amount of closure to his story with the story of the Phantom Pain and his actions and some of the things that he went through the process of that game?
I think that's a great question. I'm not sure. I mean, certainly in terms of closure, I think you get to see his journey, mm-hmm. but I don't know as you really know what was going on with him. I think you're left with a fair amount of mystery as to his motivations and is he a good guy or a bad guy? Well, I think most people find him not to be such a good guy, but not to judge or anything, but I think there's a fair amount of inner mystery to his inner workings, which right. I kind of like, you know.
Me too.
Sometimes you just don't quite know why people do certain things.
Right.
So I mean, I think the story leading up to and beyond the creation of Otacon and his taking over for his, you know, sort of following in his father's footsteps in one way or another, is clear. But the inner life of Huey, I don't know if there's any closure there or not. Yeah, that's for you guys to judge, really.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was a fantastic way to kind of personify that character as a way to say, you know, this character has many different motivations, but you're never quite sure what those are for the reason why he does the things he does. It was a great way to make me like and hate the character all at the same time. And your performance as him definitely helped in that aspect for sure.
Oh, thank you. That was the goal. So
mission accomplished.
Absolutely. Just as a quick note, as we progress, the game has been out for a month and a half or almost 2 months now. Coming on 2 months. So we are spoiler ready. So. Anybody watching, if maybe, I don't know if any of our fans have not completed the game, I don't know what they're doing.
No way.
But they're done. At least they have to be past the Huey segments, I'm sure. So as we move forward, feel free to talk freely about whatever is going on. But
You know, it's interesting, though. I mean, the thing is, you can, because of that whole thing with the tapes and everything, it's kind of optional whether you listen to those or not. So you can sort of complete the game without actually
completing the game,
following that story,
right?
You know? Which is one of the cool things about the game, because you can keep going back and finding other things. Even if you finish it, you can go back and play it again and have a completely different experience. So
trust me, us Metal Gear fans, those tapes are not optional. We listen to every single
all
one
of them.
I'm glad to hear that.
My question for you, Christopher, kind of falls in line a little bit with Ronan and Yong's. It's now that the saga is done, like, how does it feel to now have everything finished? There's literally, I mean, there's, I guess, a couple years that are still open to interpretation in the lore of the game. But now we know what happened to Huey. We know what happens with Otacon. How does it feel to go and deliver both of these character stories arcs, and now it's basically over?
There's a little bit of nostalgia. I miss them. I miss Otacon. Is really who I miss. You know, Huey's very interesting and fun to play, but there's a, I don't know. There's something very special about Otacon, who I kind of, it seems odd to say, but I sort of enjoy spending time with him, you know, when we're recording. So there's missing that. And I mean, I don't think, I don't know. I think one of the brilliant things about the whole Metal Gear world is that there's plenty of room for more stories.
Yes.
Yeah. If someone wanted to invent them, you know, and create them. So, I mean, there's something satisfying about having sort of completed a cycle like this. And also, it's interesting, I was talking to Chris Zimmerman, or not talking, we were emailing back and forth recently, the voice director for all the Metal Gear.
We had her on the show last week.
Oh, good. Yeah. Great. She's amazing.
She says hi.
Oh, she's phenomenal. Yeah. Oh, yeah, she did say
she's
hi.
She's remarkable.
She says you're her Otacon, by the way.
Well, sweet. She, you know, we were just saying that if you look back, I don't want to sound like we're tooting our own horn too much, but
go right ahead.
There was a demarcation when Metal Gear came out. There was a change, I feel, in the way games were made, because it was suddenly, you know, performance and storyline really began to take on much more significance. And so for me, there's something very gratifying about being a part of a franchise that had that impact. Right. You know what I mean?
Right.
And no, for us gamers as well, like Metal Gear Solid was the first game that I played where I felt this is the future of gaming. Before it was just kind of like, oh, this is sort of like a toy, you know? It's fun, you play, whatever.
Right.
This Metal Gear Solid was the first time where I'm like, this is a medium, a true medium, a true art form where you can experience things that you can't experience in any other medium.
Right.
And where it really took everything to the next level. And
it really was.
It was really cool.
Yeah, there was three kind of categories back in the day. You had your like Banjo-Kazooie, you know,
Mario's.
Yeah. You had your like your Baldur's Gate, which was like reading a book that you got to click on sometimes.
Sure.
And then this came in and kind of added, you know, almost like a movie.
Cinematography and
yeah. No, I mean, I remember playing like Myst. Remember Myst?
Yeah, absolutely.
That was like
exactly.
Myst, I have to say, but yeah, no. This, I think, it really changed things, and so to kind of look back on it as not that anything's ever completed, but it is sort of a completed oeuvre, really, in a way, and that's there's something very gratifying about that, you know.
Sure. Well. This next question is a doozy. It goes. It's from Yong, and it goes very in depth. So I'm gonna. I'm gonna turn it over to Yong, and I'm excited to hear what you got.
Yeah. So I want to break down this character Huey a bit, because, like you said, I didn't get this guy. Like I understood aspects of him, but I was left with just what the fuck. Like at the end of the game. So, I don't know how much in the loop you're kept about this character, because I know. For a lot of actors, sometimes you're told what you need to know at a need to know basis. So if you can't, like, if you don't know the answer to these questions, that's totally okay. We'll see what kinds of insight you can give us there.
Okay.
And but the thing about Huey is, I think they wanted us, the player, to feel the same way as Snake and Kaz, where they too are like, who, like, what is up with this guy? I think Kaz was fairly convinced he was guilty, but Snake, he was like, look, we don't have the evidence. We don't know yet. We can't pass judgment yet until we really know everything there is to know. And there was a sense of uncertainty with his character.
Right.
So I'm going to go through a list of things that Huey does and maybe ask you and to give us some insight into why he might have done what he did.
I'll do the best I can, but no
problem. Okay, cool. Sure thing. Starting with Ground Zeroes. In Ground Zeroes, I think it's made fairly clear that Huey sort of, he arranged this nuclear inspection, and then through that, Skullface manages to infiltrate MSF, and then that's where it all goes down. They destroy MSF. So my question to you is, how did that come about for Huey? Was he threatened by Skullface to some degree? Did he defect of his own volition? Was he tricked somehow? What's the story behind how Huey became involved in that aspect?
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously it wasn't written, you know.
Right.
The answers to that question are not written. So anything that I say is me making it up in the same way that you could make it up.
I think that's what's interesting.
That's the beauty. Well,
I think so too. I think so too. But I mean, and your point about actors not always knowing is very valid. I remember in Ground Zeroes, you know, there was a point where I actually found myself asking Chris, you know,
did I just do this?
Is he a good guy or a what is this?
Who am I playing?
And exactly. And you know, and questions like, did I really do this? You know, am I lying when I'm saying such and such or such and such, or am I, you know, and so to the best of our ability, we sort of sorted some of that out. I'm really avoiding your question, as you can tell.
No, no, no. I understand.
You know, I'm really actually curious about what you think, because, you know, under pressure of testimony and threat of execution, Huey denies, you know, he denies, he sort of has his own set of excuses for how things came about, and he really claims that he did not know that it was a setup. But whether you believe him or not,
I don't believe single word that man
that's
says.
That's what is crazy about the whole thing.
That's it. You don't believe him. And, you know.
But, Chris, you delivered those lines so truthfully. I've said this on the show to them. Like, I believe that Huey is lying, but I can't believe that Huey's lying because it doesn't seem like he's lying. When you delivered those lines, it's
when I was convinced for a brief second where I'm like, okay, maybe there's something more. No, wait a second. The evidence. Yong, think about the evidence. Don't believe this guy.
Well, that's great. And I mean, I think, you know, I think his powers of persuasion seem to be pretty good. Although he's looking at the work, and of course, when you're doing it, you can't see it. But when I mean, you know what you're working on, and you know all the actory things that you're supposed to know, you go with. But you don't really. You don't really know the impact of it in this format anyway until you actually see the scene, right?
Right.
So, you know, I came away from looking at some of these cut scenes kind of like going, boy, he really is a weasel, isn't he? You know? and I don't, you know, I kind of like the fact that you want to believe him, but there's just a lot of evidence that it isn't the case. And, right. You know, and I mean, you know, is justice done? And it's very interesting that Snake is kind of, what's the word?
Somewhat merciful.
He's sort of neutral, but neutral's not quite right.
Indifferent, maybe.
Well, you know, he's really the big boss. I mean, it's finally his decision what happens, right?
Right.
Which actually is kind of interesting, too, that he has that sort of power over this entire room of people who want to string Huey up. And that, and what he says, everyone abides by, which is kind of cool, too.
Yeah.
And that doesn't always happen. You're right. He says that we just don't know. Except that, you know, what we do know is he doesn't belong on our team.
Yeah, he does say that.
So we need to
sort of, he says it's not our problem to deal with. Let's get him out of here and it is what it is.
But he had the Diamond Dogs cup.
I know.
Oh, yeah, he did.
Well, I mean, you know, but it's interesting actually to look at it the other way, and we're getting very, you know, speculative about this, but it's interesting to think, well, what were, in terms of the structure of the game, what alternatives do they have, you know, if, and how would you feel about Kaz and Snake and all those guys if you watched Huey get executed?
Yeah.
I mean, how would you, as the players, how would that then reflect? I mean, would you feel that justice was done, or would you feel like, would you feel a little kind of uncomfortable with the way all of that was approached? Yeah. So.
What about you, Young? You said.
For me, what did it for me was when they played back the tape of Strangelove in the AI pod, that I was very uncertain about this character. I was going back and forth. Maybe they're being too harsh on him, maybe not. And then they played back that tape.
Have you heard
and
it,
and at
Chris?
That point, he was a guilty man. When he's when Kaz says, bring in the witness, and then the AI pod just clearly spells it out that Huey practically murdered his own wife.
Yeah, maybe.
She jumped in there.
You know, maybe. You hear her calling him to let her out.
Yeah.
But you don't know that he pushed her in there. I get what you're saying. I mean, and you know, it's a beautiful, if you really listen to the whole tape, because you can go and listen to like 25 minutes of her talking, which is a beautiful performance by Vanessa Marshall, I think. It's really beautifully done, and that's pretty unforgivable. You know, it's pretty unforgivable.
I forgave him because I didn't like Strangelove.
You forgave him? I love Strangelove. She was such a great character.
If it was me, which I guess technically it is, if I had my choice, I would have just kept Huey locked up and just let him work on stuff for me.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. Look what he did. He caused the parasites to mutate. You had to kill your own men because of Huey. See what I mean? Like, that's when you draw the line. When
that part's true.
You kill your own.
You know, I think the closest I can come to your answering your question, which was like 10 minutes ago, is that there's no question that Huey is pretty self-serving. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that if you look at him in terms of kind of an archetypical setup, you know, Snake and his team and the you guys being the players, there's a cause, there's something higher than self-interest to believe in.
I
think that Huey does not really subscribe to that. I think Huey is trying to keep himself alive, and he's not you know, physically, he doesn't have the strength. He's actually quite vulnerable. And so he is at the mercy of anybody who kind of captures him and threatens him.
Yeah.
And so I think his actions are self-serving. And, you know, you can take from that as you wish. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, I know what you mean, because he starts out with Skullface, and then the second he figures, oh, I can get protection from these Diamond Dogs guys if I get rescued, then he feels safe with them, and then he realizes, oh, they think I'm guilty, and then that's why he tries to sell the mutated parasites to Cypher and then say, maybe he can keep me safe. Right. So yeah, he's that's why I think Big Boss, or Venom Snake, casts him aside. He's like, he is not with us. He's not about the cause. It's just about Huey.
Like
and
how he tried to trick us too.
It makes a lot of I think his actions do make a lot of sense in terms of who this character is. Right. But I don't know what the hell's going on in that brain of his oftentimes.
Well, you know, the thing is that a fair amount of what he throws back at them during that trial scene and even when he's been, he's screaming and yelling in the boat when they lower him into the water. He's not 100% wrong in what he's saying to them about what they're doing, you know, and he's not wrong. Mm-hmm. It just depends on your perspective. And for me, for that kind of ambivalence in a, what is fundamentally a war game, if you will.
Yeah, of
is really, really sophisticated and interesting because, you know, pick a side of any war that both sides are 100% convinced, usually, that they are right.
Yeah.
And Huey doesn't have a side. He's self-serving, but he's smart enough to be able to observe Snake and the team and make some, I think, very astute observations about them.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, take that as...
I think Huey might be the most complex character in the game, honestly. Like, with him, there's so much to think about.
Yeah.
Now, one question that I have for you is, first of all, in Peace Walker, Huey seemed pretty, like a pretty nice guy. He didn't seem like he was going crazy. So
I agree.
What do you think was, like, Huey's breaking point? I think there was a point in which he just lost it or something, because he's such a different sort of, like, individual in Phantom Pain. So what do you think that breaking point was? When did that happen?
Well, you know, obviously it didn't happen in any of the games, so it's some event in between. You know, that's a very hard question to answer. I mean, I think if you know, his handicap and may have something to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's possible that, because even in Peace Walker, he was to some degree at the mercy of greater powers, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so, I mean, you could sort of extrapolate from that, you know, he just began to really feel used. And so began slowly in increments to just go, no, I'm going to do this stuff I have to do for myself, you know, I have to stand up for myself because,
right.
And stand
it's
up
funny you
is
should say that.
The right word.
Yeah.
His tagline for the Metal Gear trailers was a technocrat who stands his ground. That was his tagline.
Well,
so I think you kind of nailed it.
Yeah. Some degree. I mean, I can see.
We also have to keep in mind about his son as well.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. But I mean, yes, exactly. And not that he's not a particularly good father, really. But I do think, despite his actions, I definitely think he loves his son and I think felt a lot of guilt about all the stuff he did, you know, in terms of his son, anyway.
Right?
Mm-hmm. You know,
I think that's a big reason for why he locked up, or he might have locked up Strangelove in the AI pod. He was using Hal as a test for these Elanthropus, and that's when Strangelove was like, no, and so she sent Hal to the United States without his permission, basically. Or I don't want to say permission, just without his consent, and that's when he said, okay, look, this is not happening.
Get in the pod.
This is my son as well. And
and again, you know, it's a great question of, you know, where's your breaking point? Where's your point where you're gonna go so far as to sort of commit passive aggressive murder?
Great way to put it.
It sort of is, you know.
It is, though, yeah.
Not like he stabbed her or shot her or even poisoned her. He
he did nothing.
You know, just did a little bit and then just kind of walked away, you know.
Right.
So, I don't know.
You know, actually, I think that might have answered all the questions in one fell scoop.
Really?
So awesome. Actually, good. Yeah.
I did
a lot of the points that you made. Go in line with
awesome.
A lot. I mean, yeah, it's a lot of it is like, I don't want to say it's a non-answer because it is like a really good answer, but I think a lot of it, like you said, is up to us and like to fill in the gaps, because the gaps aren't there, or the gaps are there purposely, I think. Kojima intentionally made those gaps there so people would think in this way. Is he guilty? Is he not?
I think so, and I think that's really cool. I mean, I think it's great, you know, if a game like this can get people thinking about this sort of stuff, any sort of stuff, you know, just thinking about a character and wondering, you know, and even after the game's over, you're still thinking about them and why did they do this and what does that mean? And that's very exciting to me, you know, and it's one of the great things about the game. So
awesome. Sweet. Well, thank you for that, Ronan.
Sure.
Yeah, Ronan, you are up, bud.
All right. So I know you kind of talked a bit about, you know, the fact that they could add, you know, there's room to add more story to Metal Gear long after the events of the Phantom Pain. But my question to you is there anything in particular that you would have liked to have seen go on or follow the story of Huey? Is there anything that you wanted to see specifically about him that follows those events?
That's a good question.
I think it would have been really interesting to see, to get a little more insight into this relationship with Strangelove.
Okay.
And to sort of not necessarily see that breaking point, but just see that, because clearly it was a complex relationship.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Oh yeah.
You know, and I would love to see that, and. But, you know, really, I think the place where I feel that there are stories left to tell is more with Otacon.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think there are lots more potential with Otacon than with Huey of, you know, and now that we know more about Huey, there's actually a lot more potential for Otacon and his, you know, perhaps his continued discovery of who his father really was and what does that mean to him, and, you know, sort of answering some questions about his own awkwardness and, you know, social difficulties and his guilt, and I mean, you can go on and on and on. And you know, Otacon really developed from a kind of a victim in the very beginning to really a hero, you know.
Definitely.
Like an active hero
With lady trouble.
So I mean, you know, that sort of development of a character is really interesting, and then, you know, once you've reached that level, you can tell stories where he's more of a hero. Obviously, as you can tell, I'm like pushing to try and get another game centered around.
Right. Yeah, definitely. Well, I was gonna ask you, they did this with Mass Effect, but the guy who does Mass Effect is Mark Meer. I'm not sure if
you know him. Yeah, I haven't met him, but I've heard of him.
Okay. Yeah, so what they did is, after his trilogy is complete, he did a 3-game series, and what they did was, he had the same kind of thing that you said, is there was some kind of loose ends in between the stories that wasn't tied, so they actually recorded like a 5 to 8 minute long like letter that he wrote to somebody, and I don't know like how like legality stuff works, I don't know if you could do that, but I think maybe if somebody wrote something that you agreed with and it was cleared by everybody, maybe you could go into your Huey or Otacon voice and, you know, do a letter that was written between somebody or something like that. There's tons of possibilities if you don't get a game, which obviously we want you to get a game. So
I know
we'll try for that.
I would be happy to do that if Mr. Kojima would write the letter. Yeah. Then I would read it. But I mean, in the end, it is his story, you know. I mean, and we're all, you know, the fan fiction, and you can take these stories and take off in your own imagination. And I think that's fair game. I really do. And sometimes really very interesting. But
right. I think in the case that I was talking about, I'm pretty sure Mark wrote it himself.
Since it was
his character. He got clearance from, you know, whoever his person is to do it, and it was a really nice kind of sentimental thing that you don't really get to see in the game, because the game's more about combat and action, and it's definitely got its story parts, that's what it's all about, but it never really touches as soft as that particular letter was. It was really, really touching and really cool to see, and I thought that might be a perfect fit here.
Yeah.
All
maybe,
right.
Maybe a letter of from Huey to Otacon would be really cool.
Oh, that would be, that cool. would be very interesting, actually. That'd be very
What I need to see is how the hell did he survive the life raft?
They should make a movie about it.
Him
yeah,
stranded
long,
in the sea, surviving on the food he got.
I know. No, that would be very interesting. And then when he finally reached land, he didn't have his bionic legs or anything.
Right.
Yeah. So what happened, you know?
Ronan, was there any other parts to your question, buddy?
Oh, no, that was it. Chris, you answered that fantastically, so I really appreciate
Thank
that.
You. Thanks.
Perfect. So my next thing for you, Chris, is... you had literally, in my opinion, the best scene in the entire game. The game offers not as many cutscenes as we're used to. So the ones that right. we have to, you know, savor. You have
right.
the best one in the game, in my opinion, with Robin Atkins Downs in the interrogation scene, where it was brilliantly performed. So
which one? There's two interrogation scenes.
The exile scene.
Well, there's
where the
execution scene.
The enemy is right here on his knees and
hits
you with his with his crutch, and that entire encompassing scene was just quite amazing. So my question for you is, can you tell us a little bit about acting out that scene and how it was recording that particular one?
Well, it was. You know, obviously really intense. I mean, you know, it was really
was
clear.
Was Robin there with you?
No. I was either, you know, I was working two recordings or just...
Okay, so you got to hear it, though.
Well, sometimes I did and sometimes I didn't.
Okay.
It just depended. Okay. You know, there was a fair amount of Chris Zimmerman reading the lines.
Okay. She's fairly good as well, so I'm sure it was...
She's very good, but it's not quite the same as...
Right. That's Robin acting down. I'm
right.
Sure.
Not the same at all. So, and you know, it's really cool to see it cut together because it actually works pretty well.
Yeah.
That was a very intense day. What I'm trying to remember... Yeah, that must have been a facial capture day because there's a fair amount of I know the torture scene, the earlier
with Ocelot
scene was indeed that was definitely a facial capture day. So that my upper body movements are, you know, I had to match those in a studio and all of that. Which is tricky. But that final trial, and the other thing that, of course, we didn't have was the kind of crowd all yelling, you know, kill him, you know, that thing, which is really intense and really scary. I mean, I knew it was going to be there, but we didn't actually have it recorded. So, you know, as always with these things, there's a certain amount that you have to make up in your head as to what you're acting with. But I mean, I knew it was pretty crucial. It's a pretty important moment.
Awesome.
And it worked very well.
Yes.
And I do agree that it's one of my favorite scenes in the game. The cutscenes in the game, just in general, like, I mean, I don't know, say what you want about the game, but the cutscenes are so brilliantly executed. I've never seen cutscenes so just amazing, like these one shots. They're I think Kojima was inspired by Alfonso Cuarón with his work with Gravity, where he does a lot of the one shots in space. He was inspired by that, and he implemented that in Phantom Pain, and it adds this sense of immersion, like you're there behind the camera just watching this whole thing unfold without the cuts and stuff.
I agree, and I love that you bring in a film reference, you know, because I think that's right, and I think Mr. Kojima is really very into film.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it's always been my contention that he's always been trying to bridge the gap between games and movies, and he's been really very effective with it.
Definitely.
Know.
Agreed.
And I know he's been trying to do a Metal Gear movie forever, so.
Yeah.
There is
one
coming out, I think.
Still in production, right?
Sorry?
There is one in production, I believe, although I don't know how far along it is.
Right. There's been a lot of talks about that.
Yeah, I certainly don't think they've cast it or are shooting it yet.
I think they have a director.
They probably do have, you know, they probably got all that stuff. And, you know, the thing about that is, as most things with movies, it could all fall apart at any moment.
Yeah, you should play Otacon. I'm sorry, you look just like him, and you have the voice. What else do you need?
I would gladly play Otacon.
All right,
that would be awesome. You know, I don't know. Put in a word for me.
You got it.
Definitely will.
Young, you actually have the next question, so you're good to go, buddy.
So going back to Huey, tell us a bit about some of the things you had to keep in mind to play Huey. Did you play him as if he was convinced that what he was saying was true, or did you play it as if he kind of knows that he's guilty of some, like, what's the mentality that you had to keep to effectively play this character, because there's so much to him?
Right.
Well, it's tricky because I think at different moments I approached, I took different tacks, you know. Okay. I think there are times when he's lying, and I think there are times when he's lying really, really well, and then I think there are times when he's not lying so well.
A lot of lying there.
but I also think there are times when he's telling the truth from his perspective, you know?
Mm-hmm. Like on a life raft when he's spouting out all that stuff about Diamond Dogs.
Right. So, I mean, you know, the answer is all of the above, really, you know, in any given situation. And again, you know, I feel like a broken record, but Chris Zimmerman is so important to this because, you know, in the sort of piecemeal way we have to go about making this, it's keeping track of where you are what specific circumstance you're really talking about. It's really helpful to have somebody to help you with that, you know. And I know there was at least one case where I did a take of a few lines and Chris said he's not that good a liar. And so, you know, so that was always something she was keeping an eye on and I was keeping an eye on. But again, you know, it comes back to this issue of not being given all the information, you know? Sure. And as an actor, I much prefer to have all the information and then structure what I'm doing, you know, to arc it that way. Right. But you don't get that in this. So there are times where you're sort of flying blind, you know.
I see.
And again, this is where someone like Chris Zimmerman, who does have all the information, can really be helpful.
Right. Do you think it's ever going to be possible to film or shoot games like you would, like a movie or a play? I mean, you've been in some movies and television. Do you ever think there'll be a point where we're there, where you guys can actually have some of the same stuff in front of you that you would for a character on TV?
I don't know. I suspect that, see, the one, really, because of course TV or film, they're shot piece by piece as well, and out of order.
Right.
But at least there, most of the time, but not always, you have your scene partner to work with. That's the first thing. And usually, but not always, you have read the entire script, so you know the story. Not always, particularly if you're playing a small role in a movie or something.
Okay.
Or if you're doing a Woody Allen movie where he never gives anybody the whole script. He just tells you what he thinks you need to know. I would like to see that gap closed a little bit for games. I do think that at least for the near future, that games, if they're big deal sophisticated games, are going to have to use motion capture and kind of green screen, and so you're not going to have a full set, you know. You're not going to have, you're working with cardboard and frames, and you've got dots all over you, and so you have to make a lot of stuff up in a way that in a really, you know, well budgeted movie, everything's real.
Yeah, right.
So I don't know. We'll see. You know, again, it's like
if you had to choose,
we're at a turning point. Now we're at a turning point. Where are games going now?
Right.
You know, what direction are they going to go in? And I'd be very interested to see. In 5 or 10 years.
If you had to choose one to go right now, would you rather know your video game scripts in advance so you can better learn the character, or would you rather have video games start putting you with your scene partners more often in an actual physical place?
Oh, that's a really good question. I think the most important thing for me would be to be able to read the whole script.
Okay. Cool.
You know, they're both important. They're both important, but you, and you know, yeah, they're both important. But I think I'd pick the script over the other because, you know, and you still do sometimes do have a scene partner in the room, just very rarely. I mean, David Hayter and I did do a whole bunch of stuff in the room together, and Jennifer Hale and I have done scenes together too. But I'd like the script.
Okay, yeah, cool.
That was fine.
I know what you mean. Like,
it'll never happen because they're so secret.
No, when I'm in like the doing theatrical productions, like if I didn't have that whole script that I could just read and get a context for all the situation, it'd be so difficult. Because I know there are some rehearsals where some people can't make it, but because I know the script, I can still efficiently like. Act it out in a way that, you know, even though it would certainly help to have the person there during the rehearsal, knowing the script is just so, like, vital.
Well, you know, it gets to a really interesting question of, you know, well, I think that there are a lot of misconceptions about what actors really do, you know, and a really good actor in any medium will make it look like they're not doing anything, like they're not doing anything at all, like they didn't have to do any work. The whole point is to make it look really easy.
Yeah.
But to get to that, there's so much work that has to be done, and people don't understand. And you really, in order to do that work, you really are aided by knowing the entire arc of the entire story.
Gotcha.
And that's the way we are trained as actors. If you go to an acting school, you know, as I did, or even in acting classes, the first thing is read the script. You have to read the script. Read the script over and over and over again.
Yeah. You know? The first rehearsal is always a read-through, actually, for any play.
Yes, that's right. Almost always.
Yeah. Cool. Well, I think that's very insightful and cool to hear. So I think, Ronan, you're up next, bud.
All right. So we kind of already know how the three of us, that being me, Young, and Daly, feel about Huey as a character as a whole and his actions. But what I want to ask you, Chris, is how you feel about his actions. Do you feel like he may have been justified in some of the things that he did and some of the accusations that he did to the characters throughout the game?
Yeah, I think in some of them he is. But again, I mean, I think you gotta put yourself in his quite self-serving position. I mean, me personally, I don't think anyone is justified in killing anyone.
Right.
I just don't think you can justify
that. Yeah.
You know, except under just the most extreme circumstances. Huey probably felt that these were extreme circumstances that justified what his actions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. From his perspective, they were extreme circumstances.
Right.
From all of our perspective, looking on the outside, it's like, come on, dude.
Sure.
You know. So. I don't know if that actually answers your question or
no. Actually, you did completely.
Huey is like he's so victimized.
Yeah.
He's always been a victim of something.
Yes.
And if you look at it in that perspective, it certainly, I mean, I don't want to say redeems, but it certainly makes puts a new angle to things because, I mean, since the day we meet him in Peace Walker, he's under, what is it, Coldman or whatever?
Yeah,
and he's making stuff for him, and then now it's Skullface, and then even under Big Boss, he's still sort of this, he's being, you know, accused.
Manipulated, accused, yeah.
Yeah, he's, sure.
So. He's usually, like, for the most part, in a lot of his situations, he's kind of almost always working for the wrong side in some sense. And keep in mind, he was pushed down, or not pushed down, but let fall down the stairs twice.
That sucks.
Yeah, that sucks. So he's definitely been abused in more ways than one in that aspect.
I think it's also just important to also keep in mind that I think Huey likes doing what he does, though. I think he enjoys creating those the weapons. Because even when he doesn't have to, you know, he is with, like, the battle gear. And stuff. So I think it's important to just kind of figure out, you know, where his breaking point was.
Yeah.
Where it went from I'm doing this because I want to be doing it because I have to.
Yeah, and you know, like most scientists, the science is what really interests him.
Yeah.
And that you're right, the creation of these machines is what he feels he's on the planet to do, and it's his passion. And it, to some degree, anybody who's going to afford him the ability to do it, he's going to sort of go with, because he wants to do it. You know, he wants to do that. That's awesome. That's his legacy.
Yeah. A lot of people take advantage of that in Metal Gear.
Absolutely,
they do. Definitely.
Yeah, no question about it. Yeah.
All right. So moving on, my next question for you, Chris, is were you aware of the twist that this game has as far as the player character is concerned?
No, I was not.
Really?
Do you mean... It depends on which twist you're talking
about.
The
twist that I'm speaking of is that you don't actually play as Snake in the game.
As Big Boss. You play as Snake, but you don't play as Big Boss.
You play as Big Boss. Yeah.
As Big Boss.
You play as, I don't know if you've seen the cutscene in Ground Zeroes at the end where the chopper's going down and stuff.
Right. I have not seen that one.
Okay. Well, there is another character in there who's a medic, and he was in the chopper, and it's actually him we play as, and he's a representation of us, because in the beginning of the game, we actually get to make, like, an avatar. We get to choose, like, a hair color and the facial features, and that's us.
Surgery to look like
Big Boss, and then memory therapy or something, and then
I did see that, and the answer is no, I was not aware of any of that. Is one of the many things that, you know, they don't tell you.
When did you finally find out?
Well, you know, I have not actually played the game, but I have seen a lot of the scenes from it and talked to people about it. So, you know, since the game has come out, I've learned a lot more about it.
Okay.
Gotcha. So to
add on to that, just one little thing. There's one line that you say in the game when you meet Snake for the first time.
Yeah.
You say, "Snake, is that you?" And you give this look like, "Wait, I don't recognize you. I didn't recognize you for a bit." You give him that look, and that was a huge hint that this might not be the Big Boss that we know as. So did you have no idea that that's what that was alluding to when you said, when you recorded that line?
I in all honesty, I don't remember the specific recording of that line. I can't actually answer that question because I don't remember. But you're right, that's a big hint for sure.
Yeah, it's a pretty big hint.
So my actual question then, now that we know, is if you had known, do you think that would have changed your performance if you know, the character that you're interacting with, if you had a knowledge of it not actually being the Big Boss that, like Yong said, that we know, do you think that might have altered the way you approached the scenes that you had in the game?
Well, I mean, yes and no, because it's really a question of, does Huey know that it's not the Big Boss that we think it is? You know, it's like the things that are, I mean, it's always helpful to know the overarching stuff.
Do you think Huey would have recognized whether Snake had, you know, gone through some of these changes? Like I said, it's,
I don't know.
It's done
I don't
with
know.
Plastic Huey, surgery.
I mean,
so.
It's like how much time has Huey spent with Snake? You know,
right.
And
right.
How much would he? And you know, and mm-hmm. and did he, does he? You know, did he have his glasses on? And
okay,
you know,
okay.
I mean, there's
a lot of details.
And it had been nine
it's,
years.
It's dark. It's dark in that room. You know,
it
no,
is.
No, Snake's kind of hiding. He's sort of hiding in the shadows.
Yeah, you're right.
That so, you know,
yeah,
there are a lot.
Yeah, that's
there are
what
lot
I
of factors. A lot of
yeah.
Factors.
When he said Snake, is that you? I thought it was just like, oh, it's been so long. But it turns out it was like, wait, you look a slightly, there's something off about you. That's what he meant. But I interpreted it as, oh, look, it's been so long. I almost didn't recognize. It's been 9 years after all. So
when I went
yeah,
into that
it's been
room,
a long time.
When I went into that room with the AI pod and the AI pod said, that's not you. I was like, oh, man. Oh, man. All right.
Is that Snake? It's not you, is it? And I'm like, what does that mean?
Let's move on here. We're getting close to our hour mark. So, y'all, you've got the next question, buddy.
Sure. I'm going to skip the previous one because we already touched upon the technical aspects of, you know, the facial capture and all that. So,
yeah.
This next question is about both Huey and Hal. Why do you think Huey and Hal ended up being so different from each other? I mean, they have sort of, to some degree, similar backgrounds where they have both been taken advantage of, they've both been used, they've both had traumatic experiences and disturbing moments in their life, yet their paths diverged so much. And why do you think that is?
That's a good question. Huey wasn't really around that much to influence Otacon as a child.
Yeah.
So there's that, but you know, there's also, it's like nature or nurture. You know, I think they really are two very different people, and you know, I mean, I'm a lot like my dad in many ways, but in other ways, I'm not. And how can you, you know, where do you, how do you, can you tell?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I do think that I think it's pretty significant that it's not like Hal grew up with Huey around all the time,
right.
You know, and so that his influence on Hal was more of an idea than an actual presence. And
sure.
I think Hal, as it's easy for any child to do, you know, would idealize his father if his father wasn't around, idealize him from afar, and idealize his, you know, his mission in this whole nature of science and creation
right.
through science, which is what Hal pursued.
Mm-hmm.
And that I think that Hal has just naturally has a really good heart.
Yeah.
Right.
And so, you know, I think that that's his specific thing. And
sure.
Then, you know, it gets back to the question of what, you know, who is Huey really?
Yeah.
Right.
And,
who knows?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
I would
right.
like to think that a big part of it had to do with the fact that Hal, I think he met the right people. I think him meeting Solid Snake was like a big
yeah.
turning point for him yeah. where he actually looked up to Solid Snake, whereas Huey, I think he maybe feared Big Boss or something
yeah.
along those lines. I'm not sure.
Sure.
I don't know if that might have something to do with it.
That's a very interesting point. I think Huey feared a lot of things.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, and Hal's not, certainly early on, Hal's not, you know, full of bravado and courage.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
But,
sure.
but he, you know, I don't think he's quite as threatened as Huey is. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think yeah. like Solid and Huey or Hal develop like a friendship,
right.
especially in two where they start their own sort of organization, philanthropy to fight other
right.
Metal Gears, and they have this common cause and stuff. Whereas I think like Huey didn't share the cause that Big Boss shared.
Right. Right.
I don't know. It's a very interesting dynamic. It's just.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. It's, they have the same voice, so oftentimes I think of them as like, you know, similar, well, very similar people, but they're so different too.
That's
yeah, genetics. There genetics. We go. But yeah, that was my question. Thank you for answering that. Ronan, go ahead.
Yeah, Ronan, you are up, bud.
All right, so mine is going to take a little turn away from Metal Gear for a second. Uh-oh. So with the issue with the union and voice actors' rights going on right now, I'm kind of curious about what your thoughts are on that subject specifically.
Yeah, can you explain it to us a little bit as well? We talked to Paul Eiding and Chris Zimmerman last week on our show, and Paul explained it very, very briefly, but he was unsure of some of the topics. Just so you know, we talked a little bit about the demands that they're making of you guys and some of the things that they want to fine you for if you don't do and that kind of stuff. So she could clear some of that up for us also. That'd be great.
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, I'll do my best. I'm, there's some things that I'm a little vague on, but the actors union, the Screen Actors, SAG-AFTRA, is, you know, we're all the Metal Gear actors are members of that.
Right.
And I've been a member of that for years. Our contract with New Media is up. It's actually over. So we're trying to renegotiate. So that's just sort of what's happening. We are asking for certain things, and the producers have come in with certain things that they're asking for. So, and we're trying to meet in the middle. They're asking for some things that are, I think, really show, to me, kind of what I was talking about earlier, that there's a great misconception about what actors do.
Right.
And to say that it's hard work is tricky because,
I think we would agree if you did say that.
It's hard work in a different sort of way. It's not we're out, digging.
It's not like construction.
It's not like construction there's a lot of very hard jobs. But to be able to do this job effectively, I think takes a lot, not just talent, but a certain amount of training and just a certain focus. Way of going about it and a certain focus. And it is sometimes extremely physically demanding in a way that people don't understand. They think you're just standing in front of a microphone. How can that be physically demanding? And understand why they would not understand that.
I would say the same thing to anybody with that.
Can be extremely demanding, extremely stressful.
Yeah.
So, you can go, I think, on any number of websites and see what the producers are asking for and what our union is asking for. I think there's some things that the producers are asking for that are perhaps even unconstitutional, let alone, sort of unreasonable.
Yeah. Totally fine.
One of their demands was one of the things that they have on the table is that they can actually fine our agents an enormous amount of money if we refuse to audition for certain roles and certain projects.
To clear that up, if I said I want Christopher Randolph to come play a character in my game called Blood and Gore, and you didn't want to do that, I could fine you.
Yeah.
Because
I think it's even more strange than that. It's if you want me to come and audition for a role in your game called Blood and Gore, and I don't want to do it.
Right.
I don't want to come and audition. They can fine me.
That's ridiculous.
What is this, like slavery or something?
Jesus.
There's that. that now again, I have to put a caveat. That's how I understand that.
Right. I think we're on the same page. We've heard that multiple times.
May have that. I may be confused, but that's my impression of what it is. Okay. You know, the other one is yes, they want to be able to fine us if we are what they call inattentive, or you know, and basically fine us. Well, in some cases, more than the salary we would be making that day. Oh, you know, if we check our cell phone or something. And I, you know, again, to me, a demand like that betrays I want to say a lack of respect, but it's not really that. It's this notion that we are professionals. You know, we do this. This is what we do. This is what we've done with our lives. And in many cases, we've devoted our lives to it for a long time. And that's our choice. But it's not easy. You know, if you look at what the union union minimum for a day's work on a voice game, it looks like that's a substantial amount of money. Not outrageous, but you know, something you would think, well, that's a pretty good deal. But then you have to understand, we might do three of those a year. You know, I mean, it depends on what you get cast in. You're such a freelancer that you just don't know. Right. So, but the point is, if you're a member of the guild and you get a job, you're going to be professional about it. You show up on time, you turn off your phone, you're ready to work. And if there's stuff to prepare, you're prepared and you go in and you work to the absolute best of your ability to make the project great. Yeah. And the demands that are being made by the producers are assuming that we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't automatically do that. And right. And I find that troubling.
Right.
Yeah. Nope. Absolutely. Absolutely.
There's those things, and then there's also the whole issue of residuals, or they're calling it bonus payments, which is is more complicated and brings up a bunch of complicated issues. I'm glad we're asking for it. I think that we deserve it, and the way that they have structured the request for this is appropriate. But I think there are arguments all around about it. So it's going to be very interesting to me.
I think we all agreed with that. I wasn't even aware that you guys didn't get that. Quentin Flynn actually told me via Facebook one day when I was talking to him about that, and I was like, wait, what? You guys... your games make more monies than 90% of movies. There's no reason why you shouldn't. And Paul Eiding said it's in most cases just another session fee, which
that is what it is. That's
crazy.
It's every I think it's based on units. Every for every 2 million units sold, we get one more session fee up to, I don't know, 10 million units or something. So it only reflects
your performance
that are blockbusters that
are
making all that kind of money, and that we feel that our artistic contribution is one of the things that is making the game such a success, and that we would like to, in a small way, share in the financial success of the game. But it's true, we get a flat fee for our work, and that's it.
That's ridiculous. That's crazy.
Yeah, in movies they do like in animated voice work and stuff. They do, I believe.
Yes, they do
compensate the actors based on how successful it is.
In cartoons, like the Simpsons guys,
they all
get that, and in commercials and commercial voiceover, we get all of that. So,
that's insane.
So that's an issue too. And actually, interestingly, I think one of the other things that we're asking for is, whenever possible, to be given more information about,
what you're doing.
Yeah.
What we were talking about earlier, to see the script.
Yeah.
Because it benefits us.
Yeah.
And in the end, it benefits the
game, the product
as a whole.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's a complicated issue, and I think, I mean, I've seen a whole bunch of stuff on Twitter about it, and you know, I don't think what we're asking for is unreasonable, and we'll see what happens. You know.
We wish you guys the best of luck.
Absolutely.
I mean,
support.
We'll see. I mean, I certainly hope that we don't have to go as far as striking. You know, we took a vote to authorize that.
Right. We saw that.
So yes. And so
it was very successful, from what I understand.
Yes, it was.
96% said yes or something.
Have that power.
If you go on strike, voice over for indie games only and make the big guys jealous. There you go.
Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing, you know. The producers want to be able to bring their employees in to do some of these parts, you know, who are not members of the union. And again, I think this betrays, and I don't want to sound like a broken record.
It just betrays
a lack of understanding about what it is that we do, you know.
I thought one of the most egregious things that I've seen so far is, I can't remember the direct person where I originally saw this, but Paul mentioned it in our interview with him as well. But there's been some people trying to pit you guys, the voice actors, versus the people who create the games. And I think that is, I don't know who first brought that up, but I think that's totally, like, ignorant, and it's very upsetting, because they're trying to create arguments and fights and, you know, demean you guys do.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I think that argument arose out of, I think, what on some level is sort of a logical extrapolation of this, which is to say, well, if actors are going to get residuals, why shouldn't, you know, the coders or the scenic artists,
most of them are employed.
Right, exactly. And my response to that is, well, they should.
I think, yeah.
You know, and if they want to organize and fight for that, I totally support them. You know, I really do. I mean, I think that certainly, you know, game developers should share in the success of the thing they create. I mean, I feel that way about everything. I mean, I really think that, you know, employees should share.
Yeah.
You know?
Where voice actors have it hard, though, is that, you know, once their job is done for the project, you know, that's it. They got to re-interview, so to speak, re-audition. Whereas I guess with, like, programmers, they're set. You know, once you are a programmer in that company, you maintain that job and you have sort of a steady.
Right. Yeah, in theory, that's exactly right. And it's, you know, you're not necessarily freelance. You have a steady job.
Granted,
and
there are some freelancers. Just in case there's any watching, we know there are some freelance artists and stuff out there.
Yeah.
But that's completely, like, a voluntary thing if you don't want to be part of a company.
Right, they kind of move from project to project.
Right.
Sure. I mean, there are all sorts of, you know, employment options for people, and I, you know, I support people who are creating things, and I think that they should share in the financial success, because no matter what kind of artist you are, it's hard to be an artist.
Yep.
In our society today.
Absolutely.
Very true. So. And I mean, the other thing that is worth mentioning is, the other thing we're asking for is, has to do with safety, and, on, you know, mocap sets, to be able to have a fight director there and, that kind of thing. And 'cause some of the stuff that you're asked to do is physically dangerous and challenging. As is what we call vocal stress, which is, you know, because, you know, there are sessions where you're just basically yelling for a couple of hours, and that is exhausting, and you can't talk for 2 or 3 days, you know. No, it's really true.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think we also feel that that there's some compensation for that should be that too.
Wait, but, are there no fight choreographers for, you know, or any kind of choreographers for these sessions?
I can't say there are none. All I can say is there is no requirement that they have a fight director or a safety stunt coordinator.
Yeah.
So they can bring one in, but they're not required to.
Right.
So you can just show up and they'll make you do it on your own.
Fight.
Swords at the ready.
Well, thank you. I think that was a lot of good information. I think that was a great question, Ronan. Very important that we asked that, as our show is about voice actors. Mainly, we mainly interview voice actors. Occasionally, we'll get a game developer in here or something like that. But more than likely, it's a voice actor on here, and we definitely, at least from my perspective, we support you 100%.
100%.
Thank you.
Make that 200.
Young, you got the next question. I think we're getting near the end here, Chris. So I'm not sure how you're doing on time. Are you okay? You
got a couple? All right. I'm okay. Yeah, I'm okay.
Perfect. Go ahead.
Honestly, we answered like every single one of these last questions, like with previous questions.
Yeah.
I guess the one that I could ask is if Hal or Huey were to return in this, I guess, new Metal Gear series that Konami is maybe working on. I'm not sure what's going on with that. Would you maybe like to reprise that character?
Oh, if they ask me, if they ask me, absolutely. Sure.
Great.
Sure.
Cool. Well, we hope to see you back. Like, I don't know what's going to happen with the characters, if they're going to reboot the series or if they're going to use Kojima's framework to make their own. Like, I don't know what's happening.
I have no idea. And it'll be very interesting to see, and interesting to see without Kojima's hand in there, what they come up with. And, you know, it might be, you know, it could be like the reboot of Star Trek, where they just get a whole new crew.
Right.
To play, the younger versions or whatever.
Let's hope not. Let's hope not.
Yeah. You still sound exactly like you did, you know, all those years ago. I mean, honestly.
Well, that's true. Yeah, that's true, actually.
Literally, you sound just like Otacon from 1998, so I see no problem.
I do too. I see no problem.
Except there's quite a few less garbage trucks driving by this time. We heard that story again with Chris and Paul were telling us about the original, like, I guess it was a house, more or less, where you guys filmed the original one, and they were explaining the setup about how they. Yeah, you know, we talk about the work conditions now for you voice actors. I mean, look at it back then. They had everything in one room, y'all against the back wall, then the recording equipment, and then the television to watch what was going on.
Yeah, no, it was really an intense time. And then truck would go by and we'd have to stop. It was so funny. Oh, Hollywood.
Right. Rhoda, you got any wrap-up questions for Mr. Randall?
I do. I got one last question here.
Perfect. Yes.
All right. So are there any future projects that you're working on that you can talk about? You know, anything that's following after MGS that you might be working on?
I think that I can say this, that I did a session on a completely different game.
Okay.
And I can't say anything about it.
Right.
Of course.
But it's one of the big franchises.
Very cool.
Ooh. And I do not have a gigantic role, but I definitely did a session, and it's
Fallout 4.
It's pretty fun.
All right.
Awesome. Well, thank you.
Fair enough.
I'm glad to hear that.
I think that's as far, and we did it in New York too, which was really great.
Interesting.
Really, do you know when you could? When we might be able to talk to you more about it? Will it be this year or next year?
I do not know. I would guess, since we're already almost into November, I would guess next year.
Okay.
Okay.
Fallout 4.
We'll make sure to check back in with you and see what's going on there. But I'm glad you got something, because I know last time you were on the show during our eFusion week when we had the little smaller interview,
right,
you didn't have any other projects lined up at that time. And I was like, you need to be in more stuff. So.
Right. Oh, no. I would love to be in more stuff.
I think with this performance that you had in Metal Gear 5, it should really show, you know, what you can do. And if you don't win a award at the VGAs, I'm not sure who could.
Seriously.
That's very kind of
humanities.
Thank you.
Yeah. I would love it to be James Horan, but I think the who ruined it.
Such lust for revenge. Who?
Favorite line.
We definitely we need to share some of these cutscenes with you, Chris, so you can see some of the other stuff that has been going on in the Metal Gear universe. So.
Yeah.
With that, Yong, you got any community questions for Chris?
I do have a couple.
Here's some quick community questions for you, Chris.
Yeah. So we got the fourth snake from YouTube. What was your favorite scene to perform in Phantom Pain?
Good question. I think, interestingly enough, I think that long. The interrogation tapes were really interesting to record because they really went on and there was really something to play there. So I really enjoyed doing that.
Very cool. Now most of that was just you on the microphone, basically.
Yeah, it's just audio. That was just audio. But there was a real path to the way that was written, and I thought that was very, very interesting. And after that, actually, I have to say the scene where they exile me was a lot of fun. Yeah. Where they put me on the boat and I'm screaming and yelling and they lower me into the water and they take away my legs and that was a lot of fun.
That is a great scene. We got the fourth snake also has another question. Which version of Huey did you enjoy playing most? The one in Peace Walker where he's a little more happy-go-lucky, or the one in Phantom Pain where he's kind of losing it?
I think Phantom Pain, just because it's more complicated. I mean, it's so much more complicated. And that, for an actor, that's really interesting, you know.
Very cool. Awesome. P.E.S. Charlie from YouTube. What was your reaction to finding out just how different this character Huey would be in Phantom Pain for the first time?
Well, it's interesting because I found out over time. It sort of slowly dawned on me as we would do more and more. So it wasn't like they sort of sat me down and told me, or I read an entire script. But as I began to figure it out, my reaction was, "Huh, this is interesting." And then, like, this is a really interesting challenge. That was my response, because it's challenging to play. It's really complicated character. So that's fun. You don't always get that, you know. Mm-hmm.
Did they purposely not tell you that Huey would be this darker character for, I don't know, some reason?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that.
Because I feel like that'd be an important thing to tell you, you know.
Well, I see exactly what you're saying. And I think at the time I would have said the same thing. But looking back on it, I also think there's something that in a subtle way is reflected in the performance, which is me trying to wend my way through and be as honest about things as possible without, it's not, what I mean to say is I didn't come at it from the overarching view that this was a bad guy.
Oh, okay, I see.
I think that actually benefited the performance.
Okay, I see what you mean.
Okay.
That's pretty great.
That's pretty cool. That's cool.
Viking joke from YouTube. How would you prepare yourself before recording for a Huey session for Phantom Pain?
Good question. Have a couple of cups of tea to wake up. I do usually stretch out and do some vocal exercises before I go in to record, just to make sure things are, I'm relaxed and my voice is relatively warmed up. So that's really it.
Okay, cool.
And finally, just I got a bunch of comments from people to ask me to tell you that they thought your performance was amazing. A lot of them said your performance was the best in the game. They loved what you did with the character. They hated Huey to a lot of degrees, but they said that your performance shined through so well that it came across that way, and that's just phenomenal.
Well, I'm really touched by that. I mean, that really means a lot that there's that kind of response to it, I think the fan base for this game is just extraordinary. You know, people are so invested and so kind of committed to it. I love that. It makes me feel part of a community. So I'm really grateful for everyone.
I'm telling you, if you don't win a video game award, I really feel like that performance deserves something.
Absolutely.
So I would be surprised.
I appreciate that very much.
Definitely. Ronan, any community questions you see in the chat? Or
outside of the regular spam. Let's see here. All right, so we got a question here from, Ophiotoxin? I'm saying that right. It says, have you at some point disagreed with the line you had to say with Huey? Like, no, he would never say something like this. And if so, which one was it?
Ah, good question. I don't think that's ever happened. Once or twice, there have been parts of lines that have disagreed. And I can't remember specifics. But I know there have been times with both Huey and Otacon where there have been lines that have sort of disagreed with things that have happened in earlier games, and I have pointed it out and said, okay, so what does this mean? And sometimes they have been changed. Sometimes just a word or two needs to be changed so that it fits in with the previous games. But I mean, again, you know, I go in not knowing nearly as much as the people in the booth know, so I don't think I would ever say he would never say that.
Okay.
You know, I might ask about it, but then
That's a fantastic answer. Let's see anything else here? We got one that's constantly coming from Jason8285 in the chat.
Okay.
Saying, he says, how do you really feel when Huey was telling Big Boss to stop killing his men? Would the real Big Boss have killed them as well?
I don't know. I mean, it depends on what you think about the real Big Boss. I think, you know, again, killing, not good.
Right.
So,
right.
And I think that Huey, again, it's this strange dichotomy with Huey, because Huey, you know, may well have killed some folks, and his actions may have killed some folks, but I also think he has this strange moral center. So I think he probably genuinely thought that was wrong of Snake to keep doing too. So
the thing is, Big Boss had no option, or Venom Snake had no option at that point, because they were all infected, and if they got out, it would get other people infected. And you know, it was this really extreme situation.
Oh, yeah.
And what really pissed me off about Huey at that moment was that he was a big reason for why this was happening.
Yes.
He was like, Snake, what the hell? It's your fault. And I'm like, what are you talking about, dude? You caused this.
He just didn't
own up to that.
It's funny because I felt like Huey was telling him to stop because he was feeling responsible for everybody getting killed.
That's one way
to look at it. And it's only after I completed the entire game and really got to sit down and think about it, and I was like, maybe he was telling me to stop not because of any other reason than he felt morally responsible for what happened.
But then when in the ashes scene, he's like, you murdered them. It was your fault.
Yeah,
you did this. And I'm dude, what are you talking about?
Right.
I mean, he has, there's some truth to it, I suppose. But at the same time, it's like, dude,
he loves to shift the blame.
Do you know what he just did? Like, what?
That's Huey. That's who he is, you know? That's who he is.
Absolutely.
You gotta go. Figuring it out.
Yeah.
Damn it, Huey.
Damn it.
All right. I think that about wraps it up. I think most of these other questions have been asked and answered for the most part.
What I'm seeing as well.
And guys, keep in mind, if you haven't seen our original interview with Christopher Randolph, any of those questions, a lot of them we have already probably been answered. And we also had an additional follow-up interview. We'll link those a little later on.
Yes.
Well, I'll do that because we've been on here for a long time.
I also think it's very cool to look back at the hints you gave, you know, because back then the game was out. And now I'm like, oh, so that's what he meant.
I set my controller down and said, damn it, Christopher. Sitting right at my dining room table playing this game, and I saw some of the scenes like you were talking about, you know, how it's kind of dark, and I'm like,
right.
He knew the whole time.
Yeah, I had to keep you guys in the dark there, but
and we appreciate
it's okay.
That.
Yeah, it's good.
Totally fine. Absolutely.
It made the game that much more satisfying, like I said.
Exactly.
Yeah,
I know, that's the point.
To wrap up, you know what we like to do. We've got some, do we have some quotes for Chris?
I got one right here. I'm just going to put it in the chat.
We got one quote, and then I'd like, we're getting in the trend of doing a little custom quote for the intro for the video. In your Huey or Otacon. I'd like actually Otacon if you want to do Otacon.
We've got one Huey here, one Otacon.
The Otacon line I'd like to do is hello or hi, this is Otacon, or you know, this is Otacon, maybe in like your codec voice, and you're watching the codec. That's what the name of our show.
Gotcha, yeah.
So you've got the one line here from Yong as Huey, and then we'll do that other line after as Otacon, if you're okay with that.
All right, so which one is Huey?
The one on the chat right now.
Yeah, hang on, I'm not even looking at the chat. Hang on.
It's all right.
Where is the chat?
If you scroll the mouse to the bottom right, you'll see
I
like a little...
Oh,
there it is,
that's
there
good.
It is. There.
That's great.
I got it. All right.
That's good, I like that, y'all. That's creative.
My downstairs neighbors are going to really wonder what the heck's going on. All right. I'm innocent! You're the murderers! Daly, Ronan, Yong, you should be on this chair!
That was so good. You nailed it. You said it exactly like you said the line in Phantom Pain, which is amazing. Because I watched this cutscene like literally like a few minutes before we got on.
I literally just got like a chill. Like, that's great.
I feel guilty now.
Right.
Well, there you go. You should. Yes. And tell me what the Otacon one was again. Just
the Otacon.
Hey, this is Otacon. You're listening to the codec?
Yeah.
Okay. Boy, now I have to switch gears to Otacon.
Exactly. Throwback. We miss Otacon.
Yeah, okay.
Hey, this is Otacon, and you're listening to the codec.
That's perfect.
You know what's crazy is that I could tell the difference.
Yeah.
And that was like the voice is similar, but I could tell the difference. I could
one pitch high.
Like distinct enough where you can tell the difference.
That was crazy. That was it's so weird because I've never listened to the two characters like side by side. I've always listened to one or the other.
Yeah.
I've never like compared them, and that it was crazy that it actually sounded so different.
Christopher Randolph,
I'm blown away right
everybody.
Now. Okay.
All right.
Wow, amazing job. Chris, before we let you go, please let everybody know what's going on with you, where they can keep up with you. I know last time we talked to you, you said you had some plays going on, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, the plays are done, and I mentioned the secret game that I did a session on that I can't tell you anything more about
right now.
It's all right.
You know, and other than that, there's nothing specific at the moment. Although I will say that I'm setting things up so that next year I can come to some Comic Cons.
Yay!
Oh, wow.
So you know, there'll be more information out about that, and you know, certainly my Twitter feed will cover it. But we're kind of laying the groundwork. So I will be out and about next year, and hope to meet some fans. I would love that.
Awesome. Well, maybe
now,
we can.
Where can we stay updated on like any plays you may be acting in or directing?
You can go to my Twitter feed, which is at Christofran.
Okay.
And yep. and anything that's going on, you know, will be put on there. So
sounds good.
I've got that right here, guys, right above us on the top of the screen here. You can that's where you can visit his Twitter and just go give him a follow and say hello, show him some love from the show. And again, Chris, thank you for coming on third time this year.
Thank you. So
I know much. I'm sure we'll have you on again after your big secret game is announced. Maybe we can have another chat with you, and we'll check back in and see how things are rolling in the voiceover world. If it's the industry, you know, you guys get all that kind of stuff worked out. Yes, we'll keep up. We'll keep in touch. I've got your phone number. We've got your Twitters.
Good.
Have a great day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. It's always great to talk to you. It's really fun.
You too. Oh, Ronan and Yong, anything else for Chris before we let him go?
Just again, like, amazing performance as Huey. I felt so conflicted about this character, which is, I think, what you guys were going for. Mission accomplished.
Yeah, it is.
But thank just you. Amazing job. And like Daly said, I really hope you win an award.
Thank
absolutely.
You.
Agreed.
Yeah. Yeah. And thank you for coming on again. And we hope talk to you sometime later.
My pleasure. Absolutely. Stay in touch with me. Let me know what's up.
Sounds good.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you for joining us as always, Chris. Really appreciate it for the third time now. And like everybody else has been saying here, and I'm going to sound like a broken record, but fantastic job on your performance as Huey in the game. You did a fantastic job on giving us a reason to hate Huey. You definitely pulled that off quite well, I have to say. And if you don't win an award for that, it is definitely an injustice. So we'll be rooting for you on that aspect. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks, you guys.
All right, Chris. Have a good day. Bye-bye.
All right. Thanks, you too. Bye, you guys.
Here.
Christopher Randolph, ladies and gentlemen, Huey Otacon, and apparently somebody in a game that is a major title, which we will figure out here.
One of these days.
That was such an insightful interview.
It really was.
Because, the initial reaction to Huey is like, this guy is a fucking dude. Fuck this guy. But, you know, there are so many angles to him that you don't take into consideration until you sit down and think about it. And I think to get a chance to discuss with that with the man who, you know, brought this character to life was just really something very interesting. And I feel definitely more differently about Huey than just fuck this guy. Like, there's definitely so much more to him, but like still fuck this guy. You know what I'm saying?
Right. But, I hear you.
I'd love talking to Chris, and you know, it's just a testament to how, you know, A, good of a person he is, and B, good an actor as he is, because he's been on the show three times. Only guest to be on the show three times so far. But I don't think we're not going to do a post show. I think everybody's got to get out of here. Guys, originally we did plan on doing a play session with you guys. We're going to move that to tomorrow, barring Ronan having something to do.
I'll let you know what's going on with that.
We're gonna check on that. I'm very sorry. We did want to do it today, but with the Christopher Randolph interview running over an extra almost an hour and a half, there's just no time. We don't have time to do it right now. So keep in touch with us if you are a subscriber on Twitter. There's a couple of you guys in here right now. If you do want to play with us, it's going to be on PS4. I know there were some people asking where, like what system. It's going to be on PS4. It's going to be about 3 to 5 games, depending on how long they are, how short they are. I'm really good at the game, so they'll probably be really quick.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. Right.
Excuse us for trying to join you.
Pro gamer.
Load up my bullet pin. All right.
I don't know. It's going to be part of an e-sport here, Daly. Jesus. Yeah, right?
I'm open for esports offers if any of these buddies got an MGO team and they want to
get in contact with PlayStation. I heard they started their own esports league.
God damn it. We can't talk about this. We got to leave.
Okay? I'm just saying.
we have to leave. But before we leave, next week is a special week for everybody because we get to speak to the lovely Stephanie Houston. This one's going to be at an awkward time. What'd you say? It was going to be 12, Yong? You said they're 13 hours ahead of us.
Yeah,
and it's at
what time is it in Japan?
1 p.m.
Yeah, then it's at 12 a.m., okay. Which isn't actually terrible, I guess.
Yeah, that's not too bad.
Could have been worse.
Yeah.
Didn't we do like a 3 a.m. one last time? I don't know.
I think we did.
With Donna Burke.
Yeah, Donna Burke.
That was 3 a.m. That was insane.
Yep, that was ridiculous. Wasted. But she was amazing, though. She kept us all up.
She brought us back to life.
Yeah, she did. Definitely. Absolutely.
So... I think Stephanie Houston is going to do the same. I cannot wait to talk to her about Quiet, one of the most beloved characters. Yeah. And we've got other shows playing for you guys, so don't miss them. Keep up with us on Twitter at Young Yeah, at Corrupt Ronin, and at the Codec. To keep up to date on all that kind of stuff. We will do the play session though tomorrow. Like I said, if Ronin is good with it. If not, we'll keep you updated on what's going on. Ronan, anything special going on with you that you'd like to talk to the fans about?
Yes, I kind of had to push back the scary game that I was planning on playing for YouTube an extra week due to technical issues that I'm having on this end, and plus the personal issues as well. Right. I do have the archives of the streams that have been happening during the week that are going up on YouTube as the days roll on. I'll be uploading one of those once per day during the weekend. So if you happen to miss out on those, stay tuned to the YouTube feeds for that to happen. Podcast will be happening this weekend as well. So I know we didn't have one last week. Like I said, last week was kind of everything just kind of blew up into this huge catastrophe. So I had to cancel a lot of things that I had planned on doing. But hopefully I can get back into the swing of that this week. So stay tuned to Twitter, YouTube, all those feeds there. I'll keep you guys posted on what's happening there. But that's going to do it for me. So until next time, you guys stay classy, stay sharp. Don't do anything I wouldn't do. And I'll see you next time.
Awesome. Well, so glad to have you back on the show, man. Again, to close out, we have the interview next. It's Saturday, just so you guys know. I've been really, really bad about putting out videos telling you when the interviews are. I normally do that, but I've been good about doing it on Twitter. So I just want to tell you guys now, just in case I forget to put a video up. I know Yong usually does a video as well, so we've got that. But there is that on the 7th. Of next month, that's Saturday at 12 a.m. I guess technically that turns into Sunday, whatever.
Wait. Okay, so it's Saturday.
It's Saturday at 1 p.m. Japan time. So wait,
okay, that's Friday.
Okay.
12 a.m. Or rather, it's Saturday 12 a.m.
Okay, cool.
Well, Saturday 12 a.m. Japan. It's
so 1 Friday.
PM.
Come Saturday, hang out with us Friday night. Hang out with us Friday night.
Okay, so it's 11:59 on Friday, and then it becomes 12 a.m. Saturday. That's what we mean.
Right.
And then
and people are still going to get confused about what time it's starting.
Look, just show up sometime Friday, and I'll be here. Okay, I'll do another. What do we do for David Hayter? A 24-hour stream. I'll do a 12-hour stream for Stephanie. She deserves it. But we have that, and then for tomorrow's play session, the only way that I can get like a solid number on who's coming and who can play is for our subscriber and donator. So if you are one of those, like I said, contact me. We'll check it, and then we'll get you added on PS4, and we'll play with you as an appreciation for helping support the show. We really, really do appreciate it. You guys are amazing, all couple hundred of you that were joined us today. So that's it for me. Yong, what do you have going on, and anything you want to say to anybody?
Yeah,
before we
leave? You know, Fallout 4 Countdown Retrospective is still going strong. Look
forward.
How
many days we got left?
10 after tonight midnight. Yes. So yeah, it's happening, guys. what is it, nuclear winter is coming or something? Is that the saying? Nuclear winter is coming, let's just put it that way. And I know a lot of people want the Metal Gear analysis. Let me tell you, that stuff takes so long. I haven't had like a time to, I have to sit down for hours on end, because if I step away and then come back, I lose my train of thought, and I need the train of thought to be consistent, and why I haven't been releasing Metal Gear analysis. I want to do it right. I don't want to like do it in little pieces. So that stuff's coming. And then there's Dragonborn, which I did say I'm going to release this year. I literally may take off, like literally just isolate myself to Dragonborn for like two, 3 weeks. Like that'll get this project going so much. And then maybe do the analysis after that, because I really need to finish that project, and I just have had no time because so many things have been happening. You know, the codec, the plays, the
sorry,
don't worry about it. Metal Gear coming out, and then Fallout's coming out like a month later. So yeah, it's been crazy. 2 months later, whatever.
They
it's been
surprised
crazy.
Surprised us with that. So
yeah, they really did. I was expecting it to be a 2016 thing, but so the plan is Fallout 4, do content for that. Maybe take like a bunch of days off, just focusing, like literally 24/7 focused on Dragonborn Act 2. Get that finished, and then work on Metal Gear analysis and lore. I want to do one video, maybe 2 hours long, where I literally, it's basically Metal Gear, the documentary movie, whatever want to call it.
You just had like a little mini series that you were doing, and then you were like, well, we'll just wait.
Metal Gear Solid 5 is coming out.
Right.
Like, and good thing I didn't continue, because it would have been, the whole fucking thing would have been wrong.
Yeah. Yes.
I hate it too.
All right. Well, hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Codec episode 28 pre-show. There will be no post-show because we are playing Metal Gear Online with the likes of you folks, joined in the pre-show by Corrupt Ronin.
What is up, ladies and gentlemen? I am happy to be here today. I do apologize for not being during the last episode of the Codec, but I've been going through some rather dramatic issues and changes over the past few days and weeks. So
it's okay.
It's going to be back.
Wish you well, though. I'm sure everybody missed you, and everybody's keeping you in their thoughts, and we're glad to have you on today's show.
Yeah, it's always good to be back.
Young will be joining us shortly. He's not here right now. He's sorting some stuff out. We'll probably see him in about 15 minutes or so. But what we were saying before you guys could actually hear us, if you're looking at the screen right now, you're probably like, what the hell is this? This is what you're getting, because fuck Skype. Like, Skype has this, I wish I could just screen share with you guys and show you, like, Ronan's box is like a rectangle, and my box is a rectangle, but only half of his rectangle, so there's no way to proportionately grab the screen. Yeah, it's crazy.
I'm looking at the stream now, and I'm just like, whoa, that's not the usual way you have on the stream.
There's some, like, you're like this, a vertical slice.
Yeah.
Because if I was to go like this, you would stretch over the whole screen, and I'm the exact opposite. I can't capture anything but the... So fuck you, Skype. That's all I can say. Fuck you, Skype. There's a better way for this.
That's why we can't have nice things.
It's 2015. We put a man on the moon. And we can't get Skype.
You sure about that?
Government. That's what...
Like, you say you put a man on the moon, but are you sure about that?
That's funny that you say that, because during the last pre-show that I had with Yong, we were talking about like the Patriots and stuff like that, and we were talking about Metal Gear, and Yong goes, you know, really, I blame the government. And I was like, the government.
It's always the government.
Damn it. So, yeah, you just have to bear with us. I'll fix this when Yong gets in here. It'll be easier when everything is proportionate in Skype. I don't know why they can't do that, but apparently it's too hard to put two boxes next to each other. It's got to be three or more.
Hey, man, it is hard to send video over a client. You don't understand. Skype, they get paid to not do their job, so it's fine, right?
I've got to watch advertisements all day.
Exactly, just to have a software that doesn't work half the time. It's perfect.
I'm going to use Uvu.
I'm going back to Windows Live Messenger.
There you go.
MSN, there we go. MSN, that's where it's at.
We're just going to Snapchat the show from now on.
Yep.
Only 15-second tidbits.
Is AOL still in business? Yeah, they're still in business,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, they are.
Oh, that's Jesus Christ.
Chris Zimmerman had AOL. That's how she said that, too, when we were, like, getting ready to go live. She's like, hold on, let me turn off AOL. And I was like, what?
Thing?
You got a fax machine on over there? What's going on?
But hey, I can't blame her. I still have a fax machine, too, so it's okay.
Okay, I got you. Well, I think we should get into it, because there's some stuff and some things going on.
Yeah.
There's some things going on in the gaming world. And just literally, I was looking at our show, like, lineup, what we have, and we've got Stephanie Houston coming, Lori Allen's a possibility, but we've got a couple areas where we don't have the guests lined up, and I'm like, cool, we'll just do a news show. And I was damn, there's no fucking news. Lo and behold, there's some news.
Some news, all right.
So, where do you want to start? You want to talk about Halo real quick?
Let's talk about Halo. Yes, let's talk about
Halo.
Have
you played it yet?
No, I have not, because I don't have an Xbox One yet, but I do intend to at some point.
Okay. Well, you could wait, like everybody else, and get it for the PC next 50 years or so.
Yeah, they talked about that. Let's talk about that.
What kind of response is that? What kind of response is, it's not possible, but then you don't talk about it at all, and then you launch the game, and you're still like, it's not possible. I've never seen a game, with the exception of Grand Theft Auto, but they laid out their plans for this specifically.
Yeah,
I've never seen a game like this, like a AAA title, release on one platform as an exclusive and then be like, you know what, let's shell out some money to make a like make a port. No, I've never seen a company do that.
Oh yeah, that's what are you talking about? That's crazy talk.
No, that's no.
Who would do that? Who would do that?
Nobody's for PC players. They're just gonna put nude mods in the game. Damn, that's all we're good for.
I mean, they already talked about Cortana being nude half the time anyway, so whatever. There was a news article that came out about her being a nude hologram, which I guess really doesn't matter since you can't see anything regardless. Yeah. But whatever.
She's a thick girl in this game. I don't know.
Oh, wow.
Like, you look at Cortana normally, right? And you're like, all right, she's Cortana. She's a little skinny AI girl. But they put her, she's got like a physical form in this game where
right.
you can see her multiple times. And the voice acting and the lip sync is phenomenal. Like,
yeah, I've seen really cutscenes.
It looks really good. But what's the price of that? I'd like to talk a little bit about that.
All right, let's hear it.
I have played the game, and I will go spoiler-free. Not that there's anything to fucking spoil, because nothing happens in this game.
Fantastic.
There's nothing happens. Nothing. Like,
so you're saying Halo 4 and Halo 5 are the same game.
Halo 4 was even better than Halo 5, because at least like you were visiting battlefields. Like, I feel like in return for them upping the visuals and keeping at 60 frames a second, we got, like, Metal Gear Solid 1 style of corridor gameplay. Like, there was...
In 5?
Yes, there was one level towards the end that was nice and big and reminded me of real Halo, like, where you set this big, like, giant area, not map, it's just an area, and there's, like, an objective over here, and an objective over there, and an objective back there, and then you get to go and, like, choose the way you do them. That happened once. Just once.
That's sad.
Yeah.
That's kind of disappointing.
The game is 15 missions, but I beat it in less than 4 hours. The whole game in less than 4 hours.
Which is hilarious, because before the game came out, they were chalking it up as this, you know, well, we got this big 8 to 12 hour campaign.
You
beat it in 4 hours. That's...
Bungie?
All right. No, 343, you mean.
No, I want Bungie to come back.
No. I don't want Bungie to come back and miss the Halo. After Destiny, okay?
Oh,
after
God.
Destiny. I don't want Bungie to come back to Halo. I can't do it.
Think about it like this. Like, if you're Bungie and you make Halo, how do you ever top Halo? You can't. They tried. I heard Taken King's a little better, but
yeah, it's got its upsides.
But let's talk about Halo, because like I said, 60 frames a second, 1080p on the Xbox, on the Xbox One, it looks good.
Yeah.
And for, you know, lack of continuity, that's not a problem. There's cool like things that you'll notice if you're a fan of the Halo series, like Spartan Jameson Locke, the new Spartan. A lot of people were like, who is that guy? But I know who he is because I've seen the Halo movie called After Something Dark or whatever, where it's an actual Halo movie. It's like a 2 hour long movie about Halo, and he's in it.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out which one that was, because there's quite a few like short films and long films of Halo movies.
It's an actual movie.
And okay.
It's like called like Dark Something, or let me just look it up. It was good, and I was like, as soon as I saw the guy, I was like, that guy looks familiar. Where have I seen him for? Oh, he was in the movie. Let's see, it's called Halo Movie. What's it called? It's called Halo Movie.
Yep, just Halo, the movie.
No, it's Halo Movie. Nightfall. There we go. I was close. I was like, okay. Dark something. Okay.
Right.
It's Halo Nightfall. It was a nice little movie about... this group of Oni operatives, which is like the internal investigation side of the UNSC, and they go...
Wasn't that part of the Master Chief Collection that came out?
What?
The Nightfall. Didn't they have like a little exclusive thing going on with that, where if you had that game, you got to watch that? The
movie? Oh, they might have. I don't know. I just got an Xbox One, so I really do want to pick up the Master Chief Collection because it looks amazing.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
What's cool about it is... That movie, they revisit a part of the destroyed ring of the first Halo. Like, yeah, they go back to that. So, granted, there's no like memorable areas because it's blown up, but they go to a section of it and they're like harvesting some kind of bad material or whatever, and that's, I don't want to spoil the movie, but that's what it's about. Sorry. And yeah, the guy is there, is that he's in that, and he's an Oni operative, just a regular dude, and then he goes from that being that regular dude to becoming a Spartan, which is annoying to me as a Halo fan. Like, not just anybody can become a Spartan. Buck's a Spartan.
I want to be a Spartan. Make me a Spartan and you're a Spartan. Buck, yeah, Buck's a Spartan.
Buck's
yeah,
a Spartan. Buck, fucking Buck.
ODST Buck, man.
Fucking Buck.
I know. Hey, Buck, I can't the stand, hell was that? Wait,
I
wait.
Can't stand Buck. Okay, he just dies all the time, and you're always having to go revive Buck.
Buck. Hey, you so, leave him alone, okay? Nathan Fillion, he does his thing. All right.
He's a good voice actor. He's in.
No, he is.
He's
he
cool.
Is.
I like that guy. But I'd like to hear what you're thinking about what you've heard so far. You haven't played it. I know you.
Right.
You know you're not maybe the biggest Halo fan, but you like Halo, right?
Oh, no, I'm a big Halo fan, but not to a point where I'm like picking up the books and reading them constantly and shit like that.
You
don't do that.
You enjoy some Halo, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm curious what you think about it, because like you said, they promised an epic scaled campaign is what they would say. That's why they were like, we can't do split screen co-op because there's so much going on that we can't handle it.
They have a British accent too?
Yeah, well.
Oh. All right, they got it. Complete with British accent. We got the impersonations here of the 343 staff.
Take it away. I want to hear what you got.
In all honesty, like I will be forward and say that Halo has never had the most lengthy of campaigns in the games, but 4 hours to me does sound incredibly short for something that they've been touting as this big epic, well, you know, middle ground story of this new trilogy for the Halo saga. To have it at 4 hour campaign of 15 missions, and I heard that some of those missions aren't really missions.
Yeah, there's a couple parts in there where it's like weapons down and you just kind of walk around and it's like, go here, stand right here and listen to this.
Yeah, that's not
go to the next part. And it's really the game's fault. The game is like, there was a section of the game where it starts to open up a little bit. It's not huge, but it's like you go through this little cavern and then it opens up and it's like Covenant and bad guys coming in, and that was another thing, is it's the same bad guys from the other games and it's the same weapons. There's literally like nothing new. I hate the Prometheans. Like, you couldn't come up with something better than a digital dog.
a digital dog
that somehow has a weapon that when you kill him you can use it. It was a dog.
The thing that kind of what pisses me off about where Halo is going now is that I look at the premise of that franchise, that saga, that series. It takes place hundreds of years in the future.
Yes.
Why the fuck is it are we still using these 1920s ballistic weapons with actual bullets and shit while all the aliens have lasers and stuff like that? I want Ratchet and Clank style weapons. I want to see you guys go outlandish with this shit, okay?
Yeah.
Don't give me the alien version of a machine gun that I'm already using, the human version of, or the alien version of a sniper rifle. Do some crazy shit with that.
Well, I think the sniper rifles are kind of okay. Like, they've got the beam rifle, right? And they've got the light rifle. But you're right. Like, they took out the plasma, the repeater. You know, the blue one? It was like a bottom part and the top part.
Oh,
the
yeah, side. Yeah.
That's gone, and now it's the storm rifle, and it's like, just like your regular rifle that you don't have to reload, it just gets hot. I don't know. I'm disappointed. But here's the problem, okay? Here's the problem. I've dealt with all that shit from Halo. Halo 4 had the same thing. It was Prometheans and Covenant, but there was some Flood in there. There's no Flood in this game. There's no Brutes, like the big apey dudes.
Oh, fuck that. I love the Brutes.
Yeah, those are all gone. It's just your base, like, Covenant and Prometheans, and there's only three variants of each. You get your Jackal, your Grunt, your Elite, and then for the Prometheans, there's the Soldier, the Knight, and the Dog thing. I don't know what you call that. I'm just calling it the Dog.
The Dog thing.
All right. But here's the
D-Dog.
Here's the problem, is Halo 4 at least had the campaign was there. Right. It had a 10-episode Spartan ops side thing, which granted all they did was reuse the maps that they had anyways. They had like 10 maps or something like that, and they would just put different missions on them. That was still cool. That was content. That was still stuff to do,
right?
Then it had the multiplayer, and then additional to that it had the wave survival mode. And you get none of that in Halo 5. You get
blows my mind.
You get the campaign that you can't even play with your friends. You have to play on Xbox Live. Can't no split screen at all. No split screen. No like, hey, you want to play some Halo with me like we normally do for our whole life? Oh, you can't. Okay, sorry.
That's so fucked.
Now I don't have any friends. Thanks, 343. Appreciate that. My friends, all my friends.
You ruined my social life, 343. Damn it.
So there's that issue. And then the multiplayer, everything is gone except for Slayer, which is TDM. They have a new game mode called Arena, which is like capture the flag with only one flag. That's not new.
A lot of stuff sounds like it's standard Halo shit. Yeah.
Capture the flag in Halo was normally two flags, one red base, one blue base.
Oh, so you're just getting one flag.
Yeah, it's a game mode that something maybe like Day of Defeat or like Counter-Strike would do, where there's one flag in the center and both teams fight to get it back to their base,
right?
Respectively, that game mode's in there. Then there's a domination style, which that's not new, and then there's SWAT. Okay, that's the.
Love me some SWAT, man.
Yeah, I do. I like SWAT. But all the other oddballs gone. The one that they used to have with the bomb is gone.
What?
They're all gone. There's only those four or five game modes. I think it's four. Yeah, there's four. And then they have these two new game modes, which they're literally the same. It's called Warzone. And Warzone is Titanfall with objectives. So the AI in the game, it starts out. One side has one base, the other side has the other base, and then there's 3 points to capture. So it's domination, but now there's AI in there, and if you kill AI like commanders, you get an extra couple of victory points, and the first person to max victory points wins. So you know, you're fighting the Spartans, you're keeping your bases, and then you're going out and trying to kill some of the bosses. Good concept, right?
Right.
It's only like three maps.
That sounds rough. I mean, are they talking about perhaps adding more as time goes on, or is this just it?
There's more maps coming, and they will be free, but we're not done. Okay, so the other new game mode that they have is it's Warzone, the same thing, but instead of progressively going to get like the bases or whatever, you start out with X number of bases, and one side attacks and one side defends. AKA Battlefield. What's that Battlefield game mode? I know you know what it's called.
Yeah, I can't think of the name of it right now because I haven't played Battlefield.
It's not called Checkpoint, but it's called something. It's the one where after you take the first base, you have to go fall back to the next base.
Raku, I know you're in the chat. Tell us what that mode is. You play Battlefield a lot.
Damn it. Yeah, Raku, tell us what that is.
Yeah, I'm calling you out on the show.
I can't remember what it's called, but yeah, that's the other game mode. Okay, so that's it, right? Now, we've been talking. This is a good little Halo talk.
Yeah, it is.
I needed to get this off my chest.
No, it's okay.
Nobody understands. My cousin loves it. He's like, oh, man, this is the best game ever. And I'm like, it's because you don't play video games. You know what I mean? Like, they're fooling you. This is you're their
Rush.
Target.
That's the name of the mode.
Yes,
Rush.
Rush. Thank you.
Oh, Hawkeye and Raikou said that in the chat.
Hawkeye coming in with Rush. Yeah, thank you, Raikou and Hawkeye. But
yeah, thanks, guys.
So check this out. Now, do you remember in Halo 4 how you could create like your loadout, right? You unlock your guns, you get like the XP or whatever, and they would give you Spartan points, and you spend the points to unlock the weapons that you wanted, and they had like a couple little perks or whatever.
Right.
Now, in the normal game modes, in Arena, you can't use anything other than what they give you. You start out with an AR, which is the 36 round assault rifle, not the BR,
right?
And a pistol. Everything else you have to pick up from the map. You can no longer custom load out in Arena games.
Oh wow!
You can custom load out in Warzone, but you have to first reach the level of unlock every game mode. It starts from 1 to 10, I think, or 1 to 9. You start at 1, and every time you get some kills, you'll go up to the next one, the next rank. So there's rank 1 through 9. It resets every game, kind of like League of Legends.
Right.
Right. Then, when you reach a certain level, you can unlock a certain weapon, but you get the base weapons right off the jump, like the battle rifle and the AR or whatever, but they're progressive. So you start out with the AR, battle rifle's like level 3, the DMR is like level 5 or something like that. So as you progress up, but the kicker is now when a game is over, you're giving what's called a requisition pack. It's like a pack of cards. And you you open the pack of cards, and that's what you have. You have 10 warthogs. You have 10 mongooses, and you can summon those mongooses and those warthogs if you have the card to do it. And then the same thing goes for the, like, if you want a plasma rifle or a plasma cannon, those big things, you have to use a card to do that.
The more you describe this, the more it sounds like Titanfall.
Guess how you get those cards.
You got to pay real money for them.
Yeah, you can pay real money for them. You get enough points to unlock a bronze pack from a normal match if you do considerably well. If you're middle of the pack, you get about 2,000 points. That's a bronze. A bronze has like your base regular weapons, right? So if you get a gold pack, that's probably about 6 rounds or so. You can get like an overshield. Like it's so if you got some money, you can get some really, really good shit right off the fucking jump. And it's I'm annoyed.
Oh my god. So pay to win, basically. That what you're trying to tell me?
I'm sitting there, Ronan, and I'm like, I read online. It says everything can be unlocked through progression. Everything. Okay. You don't have to pay if you don't want to. And it's it's true. But I go in there and I'm like, what is this? It's like a mega pack. I'm like, oh man, that's probably like 15,000 points because a gold pack's 10. So this one's probably got to be 15. No, real money only for the mega pack. It's $24.99.
Jesus Christ. For
in-game stuff, I cannot justify that for something.
Was that best value? You probably had best value Nicholas next to it.
It's the mega pack.
Fuck, dude.
Dude, I'm so mad because for something like, let's say, Counter-Strike, you can justify paying for a weapon skin because the market fluctuates the price. That's what it is, and it's a skin that you own. I cannot justify you if I saw you go into that game and pay $2.99 for something that you can use one time, maybe. Like, there's items.
So you burn it up and it's gone.
Yeah, like if you get an overshield in your pack, you can use that overshield once. And then when you die in the game, it's gone. You have to use your next card.
Dude.
That is
so fucked.
It's insane. Like, literally, like, I'm not joking. Like, if you went in there, and I'm going to use the overshield again as an example. Let's say you just started, right? And you open your first pack. You get one overshield. You go into the match. You use that overshield, right? And you die in the game, you don't have the overshield when you respawn. You need to have another card ready to go.
Oh, man.
Fucking bastards.
Wow. So suddenly I'm not so excited to play Halo 5 multiplayer.
I want to play the arena stuff, right? You don't have to worry about this in the arena, but you can't customize your loadout. Like, you have, I don't necessarily like the AR. I kind of like the BR. I'm a BR kind of guy. And
right, yeah, yeah.
I have to go around the map and, like, memorize where it is and find it. And I get it's for balance, but offer me a game mode where I don't have to do that, like casual or whatever, where I can, you know, customize my loadout. Or offer me a game mode in Warzone where when I spend my card, I don't lose it. You know what I mean? Like, it's like a practice mode or something.
That blows my mind. That I don't know, like, the more you talk to me about it, the more it sounds like a damn MOBA. I'm just gonna put that out there. The more you talk to me about it, it sounds like a MOBA. And not to say like that's a bad thing, that's a knock against MOBAs or anything, but
$60 game.
Yeah, I don't need that in my Halo for one, and on a game that I'm already paying for two.
Yeah. I'm right on board with you. Yong's ready. He wants to come in. Let's bring So I did a lot of talking there, and I apologize.
But no, it was rant time. It's okay. We welcome rants here.
I had to say something about it. I can't go quiet when a game is stealing people's money.
Yeah.
Hey, y'all.
Uh-oh. Controversial topics yet again.
You come at the right time.
You know how we like to do it. We're talking about Halo 5.
What happened there?
I'll give you the brief summary, because we just talked about it for like 30 minutes. So basically, in the multiplayer game mode, the new one that they have, it's called Warzone. And okay. Warzone is a team-based thing. One side starts out on one side, the other starts out on the other, and they fight for three objectives in the middle. So you've got your bases, each person has a base, and then three objectives. And then, similar to Titanfall, there will be enemy AI spread out through the map. And the objective is to get the most victory points. And you can kill the AI for victory points, or you can kill the soldiers for victory points, and you get some for holding the individual structures. Here's where we were talking about where they steal your money. So when you're in the game, you start out with a rifle and a pistol. When you want to get a new weapon, you have to use what's called a requisition. And you have to have a certain amount of points. If you want a battle rifle, which is like the upgraded assault rifle, it's 3 points. Okay, so you go in there and you spend your 3 points, and you earn them over time and based on your kills, and they reset every match. So when you go into one match, you start at 1. The more kills you get up to 9. When you get to 9, you can get the best weapons and equipment for that particular match. So it rewards players that are doing well, right? So here's the thing. When you go and you get, like, let's say you get a battle rifle that's not the basic one, and you want, like, one that's upgraded, you have to have a card. And you get a card from a pack of cards that you get for money, real money, or you can play more matches to earn these cards. So let's say, Yong, you want to drive a Warthog. You have to own a Warthog on a card, and then you have to summon that with your requisition points in the game. And the way it works is when that Warthog is destroyed or when you die, you lose that card. So you'll have to go get another pack of cards. And they give you enough per match to buy some, like, bronze packs, but there's bronze, silver, gold, and a mega pack. The mega pack is money only. You can't earn it whatsoever. The gold pack is 10,000 points. The silver pack's 5, and the bronze pack is 2. So if you...
So Halo 5 has microtransactions, is what
you're
saying. Out
the fucking ass. Like, they're stealing people's money. And that's what I was telling Ronan, is... Let's say, Yong, you spent money on the game. Let's say you bought the gold pack, right? And I think it's like $10 or something, somewhere right around there. And you get a card, and it's like advanced battle rifle, right? If it's not a permanent unlock, which most of them aren't, the only ones that are permanent are like armor or like face shields or helmets. Those are permanent. But if you get like a battle rifle, times 3, like 3 of these rifles, you only use it 3 times, and then you got to buy another pack of cards. So
fuck that shit.
Yeah, that's what I said too.
Oh man.
Well, good thing I'm not buying that game then.
And here's where they get you, is when you first start out, you get a lot of packs because you're leveling up, and they're like, oh, here's a reward pack, oh, here's a pack for reaching level 5. But sooner or later, that XP, you know, you're going to need a lot more to get from, let's say, level 10 to level 12, as you would need from 1 to 2. And you got those, like, oh, man, they're giving me these packs. Now I'm not getting any. I need to get some packs. And I literally found myself, I was like, should I buy one? And when I checked the mega pack, I was like, let me see how much the mega pack is in regular currency for the game, because you get currency for beating a match or doing well. Right. And it's... $24.99 money only for the mega pack. Yeah. That's the face I made.
Yeah.
What the fuck is happening in the gaming industry?
And we just talked about it as well. The campaign was 4 hours. I beat it in 4 hours. And nothing happened. Yeah, nothing happened.
Yeah, that 8 to 12 hour campaign. Yeah.
I hear it's not as good as like the previous Halo games. You play as this really bland protagonist, and you play, I think, Master Chief
like they switch, it'll go their team Osiris and team blue has this Master Chief on it. It's like Osiris blue, and that's how it's dumb. It's like,
so
the hunt for the truth was more like the casual stroll for a conversation.
Wait, that whole marketing campaign they did for the game, was that's what it turned into? You're kidding me, right? Dude, the fuck?
I don't know. I thought I literally would have been okay with not even playing the Master Chief if the story would have been good, but it was really like, okay, you're Osiris team. This is what happened. All right, now here's Blue team. This is what happened. Oh, they just barely missed each other. And they only saw each other once through the game. And they were like, I was like, oh, this is going to be epic fight. And there was like a 2-minute fist fight with Spartan armor on. And I was like, come on, man.
Didn't they show that off in like...
Yeah, I think they did.
They already spoiled the big...
Damn it.
Yeah.
Oh, man. And then the Guardians, they don't even make sense. I'll wait for the game to be out a little bit longer before we, you know, go into spoilers about it. But
I mean, I don't know. At this point, I might just watch a damn YouTube series about it, not actually buy the game.
Well, look, if you do, it'll be the shortest YouTube series you ever watch.
Wait, but, do you have an Xbox One?
I do. I do.
Oh. I picked one up. And a PlayStation 4?
Yes, I picked one up the other day.
Okay. Hallelujah.
Well, I picked up the PS4 first.
Okay.
And I'm sold on that. I like that much better than the Xbox, actually, to be honest. But
yeah, me too.
That's what we're gonna be playing on today. But hi, y'all. Welcome to the show.
Hi. Yeah. What an interesting greeting.
Yeah.
Say hi to everybody. Everybody's been waiting for you to come on.
What's up, people?
We're doing.
How you doing? You guys ready for Halloween? You guys dressing up and stuff. Is that happening?
I think I'm gonna dress up and scare kids on the front porch.
Okay, good.
That's my thing.
It's okay. I got an apartment building, so I don't have to worry about trick or treaters. Although we did have some brave souls that decided to ring the doorbell, come up the stairs, and then get candy one time. So
you got one of those where you've got to like ring to get in.
Yep.
Nice.
To avoid getting shot around these parts. Yeah. I'm just telling you.
All right.
So that's what we've been talking a little bit about that. We've got just a few more minutes before Chris is ready. He texted me and said he was in some traffic and he would be home in just a second. I'd like to, since we're on the subject of fucking bullshit.
Shitty practices, yeah.
Let's, how are you guys receiving the Metal Gear skins? Have you even looked at them?
I don't care for them. I won't purchase them.
You're not going to buy them?
No.
You're not going to buy them?
Nope.
Nah.
We should see. I'm gonna message.
I mean, thing is, by that time, I already beat the game. Like, what do I need the skins for? I mean, the tux is kind of cool, I guess. I'd love to go into Afghanistan with a tux because, you know, why not? Proper apparel. But
is it worth 99 cents?
Exactly.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm sort of worn out by all the microtransaction shit that's happening, and I just sort of refuse to... buy. I mean, I guess that's more of a DLC kind of thing, but still, I don't
really... Are you telling me you don't have Mother Base insurance? Let's sign you right up for Mother Base insurance.
All right, let me tell you
how great Mother Base insurance is.
Dude, that would be a great video for you, Yong. That would be a great... You remember how you used to do the funny trailers? What'd you used to call them? I forget the name.
Troilers?
Yes, the Troilers. You should do one of those selling Mother Base insurance. You've got the voice for it. That would be hilarious. I might buy it.
Hi, I'm a representative of Progressive, and I would like to tell you about Mother Base insurance. Oh boy, you're missing out, good sir.
Is your base getting constantly attacked by nuclear bombs? Well, then, do we have the insurance for you? Not only does it not cover everything, but it's expensive. So
yeah, it's ridiculous.
Skins. So no skins for you. What about you, Ronan?
No skins.
No skins.
No skins.
You? Do you buy any?
No, I was tempted today. I looked at them. I forgot they came out because I've been really, really busy, like getting prepped for Fallout and doing some stuff for the channel for interviews and stuff like that. And one of our fans, Maniac, look at Hawkeye, in the chat. Did you see Hawkeye?
Hawkeye's got the jokes.
I've been busy with that, but somebody today was like, hey, Daily, do you want to enter a contest to win them? And I was like, no, I mean, save that for your, you know, your user base. I can get them if I need them. But I looked at them, and I'm like, no, I don't need that. Why? I like the battle dress or the sneaking suit. That's the only two I ever use. There's no reason to use anything other than that. And they don't add any additional benefits. I think the two for the female are, I guess, interesting. But I kind of like the balaclava for my females. I think it makes them look cool. So
yeah. True.
And they're not for MGO though, are they? They don't work in MGO.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
No, because like there's also horse armor. I don't think that translates to MGO.
Yeah. Well, I don't even use the horse anymore. Like ever since I
The horse was useful for the first maybe fourth of the game, and then. Yep. Like, why do you need this guy? Like, why is he here?
As soon as I lost Quiet, like, I was sacrificing, you know, transportation for Quiet. And as soon as I lost her, I was like, all right, I'm going to just use D-Walker because he does kind of what she does and I can ride him. And then
I went straight to D-Dog after that.
Yeah, he's good too. I like drop in like a car or something if I need to transport. But most of the drop locations, after you take out the anti-air radars, pretty close to wherever you need to go anyways. So I never felt any need to use those. And now, like, the only thing I've got left to do in the game is side ops. And I don't need skins for side ops because I'm getting pretty good with the side ops. I can just flow in, Fulton out everything, bye-bye in a couple seconds. So my question then is, they've put out this DLC, right? Do we expect more? Do you guys feel like there's anything else coming anymore? Maybe more skins? Maybe... I know MGO has some maps coming, right? Possibly. I think it launches with a few.
Maybe.
I think I've heard some things about that, yeah.
Okay, so what else... What do you guys think we're getting? What company releases a DLC skin only for the single player months after it's out and it's only $4.99?
We're not getting single player shit. I know that much.
How do you know that?
Because Kojima's out. He's officially
gone.
He's gone. I think he left. I made a video on it. Was it the New Yorker reported it? They had a goodbye party.
I heard that was not true.
Yeah, well, Konami says this, they say that. I don't even know anymore.
What
I don't really care. Kojima's going to leave, though. I mean, that's just the fact.
Yeah, that's the known commodity here.
Yeah, I get that, but they've already said that they're going to continue without him. So do you think that maybe... Well, and also you have to think that there's been a lot of, like, down development time since this game's been done, right? They could have developed something. Maybe not single-player DLC, but maybe...
I say it's not that.
Kojima Productions has been disbanded. There's no way they can continue.
Yeah, they're not going to continue.
Like, story-wise, there's no way they can do more of that. No way they're going to add more missions or anything like that. At best, we'll get more skins. That's as much as I think we will get.
Do you think that there's even the slightest remote possibility that there might be an expansion pack similar to, like, The Witcher, where it's not necessarily like a story like DLC, but it's like its own? No, you don't think
so? No
chance. They're done. That's it. They want to move on.
The issue with that daily is that it costs money to make those things. And it seems Konami these days is not about spending money.
Yeah. They're not about making money.
Even though they made like twice as much, you know, in the first day. You know, they made twice the profit of what the original cost was in the first day.
Yeah.
What was it, 179 million versus the 80 million cost in the first day, on launch day? So, you know, they're not into that.
I heard from, I think it was NeoGAF, just recently, that we just broke some numbers. We're encroaching on 10 million units sold. We're getting there.
I think it's for like Phantom Pain.
Yeah, I think
holy shit.
I think we're at
really.
I don't know. I want to look at the solid numbers.
I've been hearing stuff about them just now selling through 5 million units.
Right, that's what I'm saying. I heard it just broke a certain amount, and now
but 10 million is way different than 5 million.
That's what I'm saying. If you'll recall back a couple episodes ago, I said that I thought they were going to sell 10. So that's what I'm getting at. We broke 5, right? Somewhere around 5. Now we're on our way to 10.
You know, on launch day, it's up here, and then it sort of dies down. And if we're at 5 million at this point, I'd expect maybe 7 tops. But I don't think it's going to go beyond that.
Yeah.
10 is, 10's way too much.
We can do it. We're waiting for, I think all the PC players are waiting for MGO. Because I heard the PC wasn't terrible, but I heard it's not, like, super good. If you check the concurrent users, it's pretty high. I mean, it's definitely good. There's an easy way to check that, the Steam concurrent count, to see like how many players are playing or whatever.
Right.
But the leaderboards show quite a few, like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people playing. So I think maybe once there's an added multiplayer element, you might draw in some more people to play that. So, I mean,
yeah,
maybe possibly. I should lower my expectations. Maybe I should say 8. Maybe
just a bit.
I was trying to.
Here's what you're saying. They're gonna sell the same amount they sold on launch day up until now. They're gonna sell that again.
Yeah,
throughout the months leading up.
You think the sale throughput is that strong for it to continue flowing like that over the next few months?
Yeah. Clearly, I work for Konami. I need that shit.
All right, I gotta go. I can't do this.
Yep, I'm sorry. This interview's over, guys. I'm sorry.
Tell Christopher, I'm sorry. I just can't.
tell Christopher. I'm actually checking on Christopher right now to see where he's at. Let's see. Anyways, yeah. So I think 10 million might be out of reach, but I think we'll get close to it. And by close, I mean within a couple million.
I think I'd say 7 million tops.
Yeah, yeah. That's my prediction. Yeah, I'm around the 7 million mark too.
Which, if they hit 7 million. That allows
are you guys, this is true. 5 million that was hit recently.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of news articles have been saying they hit 5 million.
Oh, cool.
Wow. Yeah,
good for them.
Yeah, I know. I'm excited. I'm glad there's that many more people that are experiencing like everything with us. So that's
with all
really
the review
cool.
scores. I mean, the tens and stuff. I think a lot of people are like, oh, so this is a game worth looking into.
Yeah.
And I still recommend it. As much crap as I give it for, you know, things that are fan servicey or whatever that I didn't like, I still like the game as a whole.
Yeah, it's still a really good game.
We got some good insight with Chris Zimmerman when Yong and I did the interview the other day with you know, how it was recording with Kiefer, and we talked a little bit about lines like "You played me like a damn fiddle" and all that stuff, and it was a great time. And I'm excited to see like what's next, but I'm also very cautious. Like I know they're talking about another Metal Gear. Hopefully they'll bring Chris back in and she can, you know, cast the voices like she normally does, and they'll keep the same staff around, hopefully, as far as that goes. Obviously, like Yong said, Kojima Productions is gone, so we probably won't have that same experience there, but hopefully there'll be some remnants of something that regular Metal Gear fans can kind of.
I mean, you're
going on Konami's track history doesn't really.
You're going on the
optimistic about that.
Yeah, you're going on the assumption that they're planning on making a full fledged AAA Metal Gear Solid game, and that's not going to happen. I don't think that's going to happen at all, considering the fact that the Konami just filed. I want to say, didn't they file a patent not that long ago for Big Boss Pachinko?
We were going to talk about that. Yeah, we. What did you say during the pre-show the other day, Yong, about something about Guy Sihi, how he like called it?
Oh, no, he called it. I was like, you think they'll do a Metal Gear? He's like, they're definitely going to do a Metal Gear Pachinko. There's little doubt in my mind. There's no doubt in my mind, he said. And yeah, I'm like, yeah, sounds about right. And lo and behold, the day has come. Here it is. Wow. The Metal Gear Pachinko that we've all been waiting for. Jesus, now I'm going to gamble my money away.
Exactly.
Who knows? There might be hidden story details in there. Right,
that's chapter 3. Oh
yeah,
my
chapter
God.
3.
They're using this to fund chapter 3, guys. Don't worry, it's fine. It's
Yo
fine.
See, it's all part of the plan, guys. You guys need to relax.
Exactly, just chill out.
Jeez, yeah, I wonder if releasing the last-gen version of Pez on the computer was part of the plan as well, because that's something. That's something. Yeah. Did I tell you guys about that email? I
don't think you did. I don't think you did.
I got contacted by Konami after I got my Metal Gear review code, and they were like, do you want to do Pez? And I was like, sure, why not? And they were like, okay, we know you do PC. Here's a PC code. And I was like, all right, cool. So I loaded up, and it's literally the Xbox 360 version. Like, it looks like crap. Like, there's indie games that look better than that. And the animations didn't look good. The Fox Engine... Obviously, it's nice in Metal Gear, but with Pez, it's a completely different, you know, thing. You know, you're looking at crowds, and you're looking at, you know, highly detailed, you know, animations and stuff all of the time.
And this is the PC version?
Yes, this is PC version. It's the Xbox 360 version, I promise you. So I emailed them, and I was like, look, I want to do the best job possible, but I need a PS4 code. So they had to give me a PS4 code, and then now when I did the review, I had to say, I was like, hey, look, you know, because we're honest at Frag Nation, just because you don't give us, or just because you give us a code doesn't guarantee you a good score. And so I was like, hey, look, if you're on the PC, the version is subpar. Like, if you want a last gen port of a brand new game for your, you know, this machine costs more than any Xbox, then there you go. If you want the game to look its best, you need it for the PS4. So, had to do that. Now that was that's been an issue. So I don't know what they're doing, man. I'm confused. But I guess only time will tell. Like Yong was saying a couple shows ago, time will tell what they're gonna do and what this whole issue with Kojima is. And it's funny because I'm starting to see more theories flow around that he's not leaving. So. Yeah, there was two more articles by Games. I think it was Games Radar, and some other one about how it's still a big troll. I don't know. So
people are still holding on to that thing.
Yeah. Go look it up. Just Google Kojima not leaving or something like that.
And the game's out. The troll's over.
Tell him, Young.
Just saying. I mean, we found out about the ending, and there was no surprise Kojima ending where he went, "Did you like it?" Kojima not leaving Konami. Credits roll. Nothing like that happened.
David Hayter didn't pop up at the end like you were expecting.
Yeah.
Right? Oh. I was so mad. Yeah. Somebody made a good point, and I'm curious, maybe next time we have David on the show, do you guys think David will be as upset as he was knowing that it wasn't really him?
Well, Big Boss was still played by Kiefer.
Right. Yeah. But, I mean, the character overall. Like, the character you play as.
Well, that's a little... That is kind of... But here's the thing. You are Big Boss. That's the whole point that they made at the end. Like, it's right. You and me. Like, that's the whole message, right? Like, Kojima was saying, I didn't build this by myself. It was the fans and myself. And, you know, you're Big Boss. You know, as much as you are a representation of Big Boss, so you know, and that's why you had the same voice as Big Boss and stuff like that. So it was supposed to be sort of you being a part of this character and that kind of thing. So yeah, I would, you know, if I were David, I'd still be upset. It was still sort of, I guess, like his character, so to speak, character that he's been playing for so long, just in a different light.
I feel like the reason, like maybe the reason that they didn't do that is because if David did that voice and Kiefer did the other one, then it would have been very clear from the start that you're not the real, like you're not the physical person, John.
But I mean, it couldn't have just been the case of it being David. They could have put anybody else in the role of that person and it still would have given it away too.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what I'm saying. I think they had to keep it as Kiefer doing both and Atsuya doing both.
But in terms of Kiefer being or David being recasted, he'd still be upset because that's still Big Boss being played by somebody else.
Right.
And Venom Snake is like he's not the real Big Boss, but for all intents and purposes, he is Big Boss. So
he's Big Boss. Yeah.
Like, it's two Big Bosses, one fake, one real. But
I feel like we're like an Oprah show. You're Big Boss. You're a Big Boss. We're all Big Boss. Everybody's
the Oprah Winfrey show. Yeah. Sure. Why not?
Yeah, they give it. They give everything.
She'll give you a free pachinko machine after that.
You get a pachinko. You get a pachinko. Anyway, so yeah, I just wanted to talk about those couple of things. I think Chris is just about ready. So let me see if we need to take a commercial. If he just wants to call us in here on the other line, we'll hang up for just a second. So don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be right back. With Christopher Randolph, Huey, Otacon. I'm excited to talk to him about everything. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for sticking in with us for the... Whoa, what's up with these cameras? For the break, thanks for sticking with us for the break. Christopher Randolph needs a few more minutes to get prepped and get ready. He's having some PC problems and he was late getting in with traffic. So bear with us as far as the interview goes. But we got something else we'd like to talk to you guys a little bit about. We're going to continue our theme of microtransactions and weird practices that... companies seem to be doing. Yong, I don't know how familiar you are with the series, but there is a good little PC game called Payday. Started out mm-hmm. as a very, very small, little humble indie project. Not.
I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, it was it was fairly good. You know, rob banks, and you get to do it with your crew of you know, gang members or whatever, and it sold really well. Bring in Payday 2, which is their upgraded, more, you know, bigger, ambitious project, all this kind of stuff. Sold very, very well. Very loyal community, fan base, love playing the game. You can always find a game, like when you go on to log on, you never have to wait very long. Lots of content, lots of heists, lots of stuff. They promised, when they first came out, they released like a kind of like a mission statement almost. And one of the bullet points, like a FAQ, one of the bullet points on the FAQ was microtransactions, and they said, shame on you for thinking we would include microtransactions in this game. Here we are today.
Do not tell me that they actually...
Let me explain this to you, because I'm gonna let Ronan dish out the kind of justice that needs to be dished here, but let me explain to you why this is particularly bad. We see microtransactions all the time. It's all obviously not something that you know, raises an eyebrow nowadays. I mean, it kind of does, but not like, oh my god, there's microtransactions into the world. But first of all, you have that issue here with them saying there's not going to be microtransactions. Now there is. But check this out. So the way it works is, in Payday, there is a set number of weapons. There's like 10, we'll just say there's 10 weapons in the game. There's a little more than that. Then they have lots of DLC, and it's fairly cheap. It's good DLC. It's like $4. You get weapons, masks, different colors, different patterns. Some have access to different heists, but everybody can play the heist. Like, let's say you don't own the DLC, but I bought the Big Bank DLC. You can still play the Big Bank with me. You just can't host it yourself. Okay? So it's okay. It's fine. The weapon DLC is it's the opposite. You can't use the weapons, but you can still see them in the matches. But here's the problem, is now at the end of a match, you're given a card. And on the card, there is either a weapon mod, a mask, a skin, or whatever the case may be. And now on the cards that you get, you can get a safe. The safe must be opened with a drill. The drill costs $2.49. When you open the case, you don't have any control over what's given to you. So you, Yong, could, let's say you paid $2.49 to open the case, the drill, get the drill to open the case, right?
Okay.
You get a skin for a weapon that you don't own because you didn't buy that DLC. Now you have this random weapon skin. Like for me, I got it the first time. I paid $2.49 to open the safe just to make a video about it. And I got an RPG skin for a pack that I don't even own. I don't even have an RPG. I can't get it until I go buy the RPG pack DLC. Then I can use the skin that I got for that particular weapon. So, for instance, to show you somebody that maybe has done it better, that we can kind of compliment, we'll talk about Counter-Strike. With Counter-Strike, you open a case, and it's for, you own all the weapons, so it doesn't matter what skin you get, it applies to all of your loadout. In Payday, you can buy a skin that applies to a weapon that you don't even own. And so, you could resell the skin, but the skins resell, it costs $2.49 to open it, and the skins resell for like 10 cents, or 5 cents, depending on... Yep. Yeah. All right, Ronan. let Yong know where you're at, and then we'll talk to Yong and see how he feels. Because he looks genuinely frustrated right now. What is it? Because when we were off air just a second ago, guys, Yong and Ronan both made the case, like, where is this gaming industry going? Like, why is it going here? We don't want it to be there, and I think everybody's pretty vocal about that.
I think everyone is vocal about that, but I think the people that the industry pays attention to when it comes to stuff like this aren't vocal enough.
Okay.
Well, in all honesty, and truth be told, like, I listen to a lot of news outlets that talk about things like this, right. And for the most part, a lot of them will say, "Oh yeah, you know, that's totally fine. You don't have to buy this stuff. They can do this if they want to. It's great." Those are the people that the industry is listening to.
You sons of bitches.
So when it comes down to this whole thing with Payday 2, it's like, you guys released this game that, in my honest opinion, was okay, not amazing. I wasn't the biggest fan of Payday 2, so to put that out there right now. But on top of the fact that you guys gave the idea that you were listening to the community's feedback and updating and patching the game to accommodate that, which I respect as a game developer. Absolutely, that's a good thing that you do. But to sit there and say that you won't include microtransactions and then turn around years later and include microtransactions tells me that you guys are not in a good place financially as a company, and you have to do this to fund perhaps whatever next project you have in store. But even then, you guys unleash this torrent of DLC, whether that be guns, missions, characters, the works, and then expect them to have all of this when you throw in microtransactions on top of that. That sounds ridiculous.
Yeah, it really does. It's frustrating and annoying. I mean, as Young, I'm assuming you don't play Payday, correct?
I've seen it. I don't really play it. Is it fun, at least?
It's decent.
It has its moments. If you're not playing with friends, then
no.
The fuck that.
Fuck it's that. Not. But as an outsider looking and hearing about, you know, an indie game do this kind of thing, I'd like to get your opinion as, you know, somebody who you mainly cover, you know, AAA titles and stuff like that. So you're kind of used to, you know, seeing, you know, the big companies do this, which is by no means okay, but it's a little more acceptable because you are getting, like, way more content. Payday is literally, it's just multiplayer. It does have a single player, but the AI are dreadful. Like, yeah. I'd rather play with somebody you can't see than play with,
Jesus
with
Christ.
The AI in this game. So, so with that said, looking in on a, you know, an indie studio doing like this, something, you know, where they say, hey, you know, shame on you for thinking we would have DL or microtransactions in this game, and then here they are, literally randomly, no announcement. They do this thing called Crime Fest once a year, and it's where they put like a big emphasis on their game, and they change up some of the dynamics, and they add in some missions, and it's supposed to be like a big event. That's what they did for this event, is they added in the microtransactions inside of the event. They were like, hey, look at all this cool stuff. There's the microtransactions. Good job. So what do you think about a company like this doing something that's kind of rude?
Two words. Witcher 3. CD Projekt started out as kind of an indie development studio, and they still kind of are. They're self-published.
Right?
Yeah.
So, and they've grown into this big company because, you know, the passion and success they've had with that they've put into the Witcher series, and now that they've become big, they haven't followed suit with what all these other major companies do. They've gone above and beyond. I mean, honestly, how many free DLCs did we get with Witcher 3? Like
16? A dozen
or 16 or something like that?
Yeah, 16.
Those were all free. They added a bunch of new shit that just really improved the game, like tons of new content. And then they released an expansion, but guess what? It was an expansion. It wasn't some bullshit DLC. It actually added to the game. They developed this thing not because it wasn't a piece that they took out on purpose to sell separately later. Right. They made the game. They completed the game. They're like, okay, let's add more to it. That, you know, the word expansion, I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, you developers out there. It's not,
tell them, Young.
It's not taking a cheesecake, cutting a piece out of it, and saying, hey, I'm going to expand this cheesecake by putting back a piece of it in there. That's not an expansion. See, that's just putting what was supposed to be there back in place. An expansion is when you take a cheesecake and take maybe a smaller cheesecake and put that on top. That's an expansion because you make the cheesecake bigger, see? You're expanding.
Am I
communicating this properly with you guys?
Is
this too much for you guys to understand?
Yeah, everybody. Young, yeah. Well said, sir.
Preach it, man.
I literally couldn't have said it better myself. CD Projekt Red.
It's just ridiculous because coming from a time where expansions were actually expansions back in the early PC days, coming to this where people call expansions or DLC expansions, which makes no sense to me at all.
It's been quite a while. I think Witcher is one of the first games to deliver a solid expansion.
Expansion, yeah.
In a long time. I think you know, prior to whatever happened, like, there was a good period where there was expansions. I think Battlefield 2, I use that as a good example. They had good expansion packs. They had the game came out, and they set out one expansion pack that did really well. They sent out another one, and it seems like after that, they were like, oh, look at this. Look what we could do if we... All right, let's have all this expansion stuff done before. We could just sell it later. Like, no, that's where you done fucked up. That's where I personally, that's where I start to see it. I'm sure there was some other market trends around that time. But, yeah, with this Payday thing, the response has been bad. Lots of people don't like it. And so they took to Reddit for an Ask Me Anything. And... Everybody knows that can only go one way.
Oh, it goes well, doesn't it? It goes fantastically.
Yeah, it's literally the opposite of that.
I know.
I know you know. So they go to Reddit for an Ask Me Anything, and this is, I guess, kind of part two to the conversation. Everybody loves the cheesecake analogy, by the way. That was great. I think that might be the intro.
Yeah, seriously.
If Chris can't deliver us something good, I'm putting the cheesecake rant in the front. All right, so on the Ask Me Anything, the developer who people assumed, normally they're a good group of guys. They assumed that they would, you know, receive the feedback well and, you know, deal with it. They blamed the media outlets for misconstruing their stories. But it's clear as day. What happened was after the feedback and prior to the Ask Me Anything, they went back in and did an update to the game where now you have a incredibly rare chance to get a key to drop for the safe. But there's multiple different safes. So now you can get a key for a safe that you don't even have. So it's kind of fixing the problem without fixing the problem. I don't know how that system even makes sense. And additionally, that system's already flawed. For people who play the game, you'll know that, like Ronan, like you know, you can get cash for that. And it's like 50 grand. And in that game, 50 grand is about the equivalent of 5 cents.
Yep.
You can buy nothing with 50 grand. 50 grand doesn't do anything. And there's already other issues with the game, whereas, like, if you're playing the game, like, let's say all three of us are playing, right? And we're having a good old time. We're playing the big map where we're heisting all this money. We got millions in the truck. And my internet goes out. You guys all lose all your shit. You don't get – there's no, like, progressive save. There's no, like, you made it this far. We'll tally up what you made to this point. You lose connection, you lose everything. You get to the card screen. Let's say you complete the heist. You get to the card screen and you're picking cards and you lose connection to the server, you lose everything. You know, you got to start all over.
And it makes me think, what did people like about this game again when shit like this is happening?
Damn it, Roland. Because what game can you be a bad guy?
There's a lot of games that do that out there, but they don't punish you for shit like that.
The Battlefield Hardline.
I don't want to get into that one. I won't even get into that.
Can we talk about something positive before Chris gets here?
Yeah, for God's sake, guys. I am seriously depressed right now.
Let's talk about something positive because Chris said he'll be here in any minute.
All right.
Let's talk about Fallout 4.
Okay.
All right. Positive news. Let's go. Right. Yeah,
so we did. Me and Ronan did quite a bit of talking here. So Yong, tell us, how is the retrospective going for Fallout 4? And just how much have you learned since last time we talked about it? And is there any kind of cool, like, insight you can tell us about?
Yeah, the retrospective is going well. It's kind of cool to look back and walk down memory lane again and see, like, oh, I remember when I thought this thing about that one rumor that, you know, turned out to be fake, or that one rumor that actually turned out to be real and stuff like that. So it's going really well. I recommend you guys go check it out if you want to walk down memory lane. It's pretty interesting. But honestly, though, in terms of new stuff, Bethesda's been keeping their cards so close to their chest that there really hasn't been a lot that's new. I mean, we got that character development video where we
saw a bunch of those perks. We saw some of the descriptions.
Right. Yeah.
And we sort of got an understanding of how the character development system will work, which is very interesting the way it works now.
Right.
It's all like perks based.
Yeah.
And it's about, and each rank of the perk though is sort of a perk within the perk, because every rank offers like new like abilities or features right. that enhances your character. So it's, we learned about that. And then recently they released a whole like 14-second video about the Big Leaks perk. And they showed basically a montage of people's heads getting blown off by bats.
Yeah.
Yeah, with a baseball bat, yeah. Which was really nice and fun. But something that I saw there also was a glimpse of the loot system. I don't know if you guys saw that.
I have.
It was like a brief second where he blew the guy's head off, and he was looking at the guy. And you know, as soon as he blew his head off, he became a corpse. So the loot sort of screen came up for like a brief second, and then it disappeared because the corpse tipped over, and then he wasn't on his reticule anymore.
Right.
So I made an analysis video about this. So I think the loot system in Fallout 4 happens live now. It doesn't pause the game like in Skyrim or in Fallout 3. I think you just look at a corpse and the loot thing pops up immediately, and then you can use the D-pad to select whatever you want to transfer over or steal or. So that was actually very interesting, because Bethesda's never done that. And what that means is that you can't like loot in the middle of battle, which I never thought made sense anyway.
Right.
Like, there's huge firefight, you run up to a corpse, time freezes, and you're just like grabbing shit. You know, it's weird to think about that. So now you can't.
Changing your clothes out, swapping.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So you can't do that anymore. And hell, I would even say that the in Fallout 3, when you look at the Pip-Boy.
Mm.
That pauses the game, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah,
normally.
I don't think that's the case with Fallout 4, because you can see the guy when they showed off the Pip-Boy,
right.
You can see him moving his arm around, and right. You can see the world, it's still going on, and time isn't frozen.
Right.
So
right.
I think they're going, I don't want to say the Metal Gear route, like they, you know, invented this, you know, where you pull up the iDroid, but things are still happening.
Right.
So you can't look at your menu and, you know, look through your inventory in the middle of battle. Now you gotta actually go somewhere safe before you can look at your Pip-Boy, before you can loot. So I think they're going for a more sort of immersive experience where the game doesn't pause, like almost never.
So it's all just real time from start to finish, basically.
I think it's all real time based on that, the Big Leaks footage where the loot system popped up while the corpse was falling over.
Okay.
And it's so brief. It's like 2 frames maybe where it happens. But
right.
So that's new, I think, that I something new that I discovered a few days ago. That's pretty much it though. All the other footage, it's stuff from E3 or stuff from QuakeCon, or they really haven't shared much else, and I don't think they will, which I find a kind of refreshing, because Metal Gear Solid 5 showed way too much. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's, they did.
I had the pleasure of being at the review event before they showed off Sahelanthropus in the final trailer.
Mm.
Like, that was so cool when I first saw Sahelanthropus standing on 2 legs like a person. Like, that was one of the coolest moments in the game that got ruined because of that trailer.
Yes. Yes.
Like, I don't know why Kojima decided to show that. So with
double dose of that.
I did. It pissed me off. It pissed me off.
Yeah.
Just spoiled all heavens.
They're going the complete opposite way, where we don't know, like, nothing. All we know is the pre-war stuff happens. We wake up 200 years later, probably through cryogenic sleep based on Kotaku's leak, which most of it has been confirmed to be real. And then that's it. Like, what else? Like, what is the plot about? Is it about finding your family? Is it about saving the world? Is it a mix of both? We don't know, and that's the beauty of it. I think when we play Fallout 4, we're going to be compelled. We're going to be just so, like, in the dark. It's going to be awesome. That's what I love about Fallout 4 right now.
Yeah,
we don't know shit about it.
I think the best thing that they could have done was show off the city building feature, or whatever, the town building feature, because that has nothing to do with the story. Like, right. So you're not ruining elements. You can still get to show off some gameplay and you get to, you know, kind of hype everybody up for some of the, you know, upcoming stuff. But, you know, they're kind of straying away from, you know, showing anything story or spoiler-related material, which you just can't do in Metal Gear. I mean, if you show a picture of a boy with a hat, you get guys that can make, you know, 20-minute long analysis on it. So I think you know, with Fallout, they're taking, like you said, a much better approach. But one thing that is I don't want to say worrisome, but one thing that kind of caught my attention was I heard, and I could be wrong, but I heard there was only a few companions this time in the 12. Game. Yeah. Any reason, particular reason why you think they would do that? I liked you know, Fallout, where you could find like these random companions, like like the super mutant that you could find in Fallout 3, or the different ones that you could find throughout New Vegas. Like, I thought that was really cool.
Are there more than 12 in Fallout 3 in New Vegas?
Well, I don't think so, but I'm expecting more now from my next gen stuff, and that's okay. Something else that we were talking about with Halo, where, you know, Halo is now, it's on the Xbox 360, and I feel like they sacrificed the story and the content that you get to make it look 60 frames a second, 1080p. And I feel like, obviously, maybe Fallout might not have that particular problem because they're approaching the graphics, you know, from a different, you know, way.
Right.
But I'm sure they're still shooting for 60 frames a second, and I'm curious.
It's 30. Fallout 4.
On console.
On PC, it's 60. PC, it's whatever the fuck you want.
Right, yeah. Right.
Okay, well, I'm good. Tell me that. Okay, well, that's weird that it's that shooting for 30. That's weird.
I mean, it really depends on how big you're trying to make your game. And the consoles, they may be great, but they're not like the next the second coming of Jesus Christ. So they got to make those sacrifices.
That's what they say. They say, and also, cloud power is the term I hear a lot now. So,
but keep in mind, Fallout 4 isn't like, it isn't Halo. It's not a first person. Like, it is first person, but it's not a first person shooter.
It's not a Twitch shooter. Yeah, it's not a Twitch shooter.
Exactly. You can get away with 30 frames per second with. Right. And I think Destiny, that game's on consoles only, that runs at 30 frames per second, right? Yeah. And honestly, it's fine, that game. I mean, I have a lot of complaints about that game, obviously, in terms of story and all that shit. But in terms of the shooting mechanics, it's actually pretty solid.
It's pretty good.
Even though it's at 30 frames per second, which is impressive. So I think console players will be just fine with the 30 frames per second. And, you know, there's some people say, oh, 60 frames per second makes cinematic stuff look weird. I think that's, you know, I don't know. It's a weird excuse for making a game less smooth. But for some people, that's the case. So if you're into that, and if you're into 30 frames per second to make it look more cinematic, you can have that.
We all need to go the order route and just go 24 frames a second.
Yeah, there we go. Do you guys order the Pip-Boy edition?
I did not.
No. I did.
It was
the second
out.
It was announced, I was like, Amazon.com, bam, done.
It was sold out by the time that I got around to it, because I can't remember what was going on, but something else was happening, and I was like, I'll just check on this in like a week or so. And that's when you should have not done that.
Check on this
in a week.
So now I'm gonna, I need to like beg Bethesda to send me one for, because
they don't have any more.
Since I'm such a valued reviewer,
you're a big fan of their games. You own all their products. You even named their son after one of the Skyrim.
wrong person.
My son will be called Dovahkiin, Dragonborn.
I've got some bad news. It's not terrible news, but it's bad.
Are we going to the depressing side of things again?
No, okay. Chris just...
It all comes full circle.
Chris just texted me, and he said that he needs another few minutes, so we got to keep talking, I guess.
Let's keep this train rolling, then, I guess.
My teleprompter's done. I don't have any more, guys.
You know what's funny? Is I was literally talking to my cousin. He was over here the other day, and we were watching a radio show, and it's all over ESPN right now. Where they had some technical difficulties, and the people up there had no idea what to do. Like, they were just standing there, and the guy was like, "We don't have any picture. I'll let you know as soon as we do." And it was an awkward, almost 5 minutes of him saying, like, they lost connection. Like, we know that. We know you don't have connection. We're looking at you. And they wrote a big article about him on ESPN and stuff like that, and a couple other news articles.
Wait, this is who? Some guy from ESPN.
Yeah, he's a like a sports announcer or whatever. And I'm like, yeah. You know, I'm like, I do a show with a streamer, a YouTuber, and an old white guy. I'm the old white guy.
Oh, I thought that was me. Sorry. I got lost there for a second.
Which one are you talking about?
Yeah, right. I'm like, which one?
Huh? We want to be clear. You know.
Okay. All right. Just making sure.
We don't put designations on anybody except ourselves. You know what I mean? But I was like, we do this, and I guarantee you, we've worked through more technical difficulties in our couple months of streaming than ESPN's done in their entire life of broadcasting, and we don't have this problem.
Maybe they're just so not used to having technical problems that when it hits, they don't know what the fuck to do.
It's like the like, you know, like those happened.
Right, but I feel like it's actually there are some people, I'm not going to say any names, but the person that we talked about off air,
just wink three times and then I'll understand what you're okay.
There's some people who can't do anything without a script. There's some people who just can't do one thing. Scripts are great, and teleprompters and that kind of stuff, they're great to keep things organized. I'm sure Young shooting an analysis video that's an hour long would be impossible to do without that. But yeah. Something like this, like a live show, you either got it or you don't.
I feel like you made the person you're talking about too obvious when you said that. I think you might have made it.
I actually have no idea what you guys are talking about.
We just the particular person that we just talked about in the off stream who may or may not cosplay some.
I know exactly who he was talking about when he said one thing. And I'm like, I think he might have made that too obvious.
Well, that was the response that I got, is that if it's not on a script, I can't do it. So, sorry. But
anyway. I mean, hey, look, I do this shit every day. So, like, right. I have to kind of just be on point at all times when I can.
Yeah.
I think it's important, though, that as people in this particular industry kind of come up and do their, you know, do their own things, that they go at it kind of a 50-50. Like, I would say this show is unscripted. However, we have a questions list that we use to keep ourselves organized.
Bullet points, basically.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
Like, that's important that you keep, you know, that professional flow, which we normally do. I mean, sometimes we get a little fanny. Over here, fanny's probably the worst word to use for that. Fanboyish.
Just fanny.
Ronan, stop. I can't.
Two different meanings.
I can't work when you look at me like this, okay?
No, it's not my fault you said fanny, okay? There's a million different interpretations for that word, all right?
Look,
that's all I'm saying.
Look, I'm only one person, okay? I work at ESPN. I think it's important to have a structure to whatever you're doing. In fact, I talked about that today with my boss for quite some time. We've got a structure, but everything else is free flow. Like, this particular section of the show is completely unscripted. I don't know if people know that, but I just come in here and I'm like, hey, let's talk about this and then this and then this. And it gets you honest and you know, upfront feedback. I mean, when else have you ever seen Yong just go like this? When we're talking about like a game developer or something.
Or talk
like
about cheesecake. I haven't talked about cheesecake in years, guys. Exactly. None of that was on teleprompter, I can promise you that.
That made me want cheesecake, that's for sure.
Exactly.
Yeah, but, me too, actually.
I don't like cheesecake. I
how
don't.
Dare
get out!
Out of here!
I don't know how y'all like it. It tastes weird. It tastes like, I don't know, sour. I don't know. Maybe
it's the perfect combination of sweet and sour, and it's not even too sour though. It's like it's a tinge of sour, just enough to balance the sweet.
Right?
You got the bread at the bottom, and it's like the textures like blend in perfectly.
I don't like pie either. Do you guys like pie?
I can't do this. I'm out. That's it. We're done.
Noticed you got a haircut, by the way. It looks good. Looks good.
Yeah.
Wow. I like cake and ice cream.
No, okay. I'll get you on that one because I actually don't like cake.
See,
I don't like cake.
See, who's
happening right now? Here's the thing, though. Cheesecake is a form of cake. It's like saying like a square is an erection.
The texture is a bit different when it comes to cheesecake, like, though.
It's like eating pudding. That's gross. Okay,
it depends on the cake, though. Like, if you get that dry ass cake that a lot of these markets make, I can't do that shit. I can't do it.
We are video gamers. Why are we talking about food?
Because I might be hungry right now. It's just, horrible. Hey.
People are going to be like, these guys are just trying to kill time. And really, we've got things to talk about and stuff to do, but we're talking about cheesecake.
So, Christopher, want to come on now? I think we're running out of
things. We're running out of things to talk about.
Really not, because there's really so many depressing things and great things to talk about. Let's talk about one more good thing, and that is, now that I have you both here, the reversal of the pre-order DLC for that game that you guys like that I don't, and we're going to,
Deuces X?
Yeah. Let's talk about that real quick.
Now
that I think we've talked about that individually, but now I have both of you guys on here.
Oh, right.
We had the show where we talked about how it wasn't a good thing for the for the industry, and how it was less than kind of reputable for them to do it that way, to offer things that they could clearly give you. So now that that decision has been reversed, I think. What was it? A week, two weeks after the show, something like that, right?
I want to say it was about 2 or 3 weeks.
Right, lot enough time for other people to talk about it as well. Do you guys feel like them reversing that decision has any effect on like long term? What we'll see, maybe not just from that particular company. Who's producing that, by the way? Do you know?
What Square Enix is publishing? Square Enix.
Eidos is developing it.
Okay.
Eidos
and Square Enix. Okay, so the guys behind Hitman, right?
I believe. Yeah. Really?
I think Hitman is IO Interactive.
Okay. I thought it was Eidos, EIDOS or something like that.
Yeah, it is Eidos Interactive. Yeah, okay. That's Hitman.
Okay, so the that's not Chris. That's just sweet. Okay. I was like, what? Okay. Anyways.
Got my hopes up there.
Do you guys think that something like this will affect what we see, not just from this company, but from other people with maybe weird, shady DLC practices? Yong, you want to start?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
The question was, do you think having now that Deus Ex has changed their pre-order bonuses, do you think that that will have any long-term effect for other companies offering this? Do you think we won't see something like this again, or do you think they'll try it maybe in a different way and moving forward?
They won't. I don't think they'll try that particular strategy again, but they're going to keep trying to, you know, squeeze out as much money from our wallets as possible. That's just the nature of things, and it's not going to change until people start speaking up. But they're not. They're just buying. They're actually buying their stuff, and it's working, which is why they keep doing it. So, I don't think the practice itself is going to change. But they're going to try new methods.
Or does it really? Does it not change anything?
This is definitely a win.
Right.
I mean, that was bullshit. What they were doing with Deus Ex, not Human Revolution, Mankind Divided. That was This is definitely a victory, and I think this is what happens when people speak up.
Yeah.
But I think this one in particular was so bullshitty though that I think. It was beyond anything people had seen, honestly. It was just so shady. People spoke up, and guess what? They reversed it. They had, at least I'll give them this, they had the decency to, you know, recognize that people hated this bullshit, and they're like, okay, you know what? Okay, you guys have spoken, all right. You know, maybe it was a little too much. At least they recognized that it was kind of a mistake to do this, and they reversed it. So that much, I can give them that, at least. Right. Other companies don't give a fuck. They're like, well, whatever, you know. We're going to get your money. That's what it's all about. So, you know, like EA and Ubisoft. So, but it is most certainly a victory. They heard the pleas of the people and they reversed it, and hopefully other companies will follow suit. But I don't know if that's, it's a small victory. I don't think it's going to revolutionize the way DLCs and microtransactions happen, but something's better than nothing, I guess.
Now, Ronan, for you, do you think there's some people have pointed out that there's a trend, and I'm curious if you agree or disagree and what your thoughts on the trend are.
Okay.
But people tend to see now that when developers do things like this, for instance, with microtransactions in games or DLC, in the case of Deus Ex, these pre-order bonuses, they tend to almost ignore the problem and then just release the game anyways and wait for it to go away.
Right.
Do you think that that's what's going on, and do you have an opinion on, you know, how that can affect, you know, us as consumers if they're not listening to us?
And it completely, in all honesty, I think that it depends on the publisher themselves and how they look at things like this. If they're looking, because I read an article a few days ago when people were talking about publishers and microtransactions and pre-order DLC, it was kind of the case of, hey, look, guys, money is kind of what makes this go around, so we have to do this, sorry. So in a sense, it depends on the publisher. It depends on how bad they want it. It depends on if they care about what their audience is looking for and what their thoughts are on things like this. But for the most part, situations like this Deus Ex thing, sadly, are kind of rare. And we can take this as a victory because it is a victory. It's a small victory, but it is a victory. But like Yong said, there's a pretty good chance we'll see this come back up again in a different form, but the same process for maybe a different publisher at some point in the future, and we'll have to fight this down again. It's kind of the same thing that's going on with internet service providers and the FCC, for example, where they keep trying to propose this law about internet fast and slow lanes. When it gets shot down, they keep bringing it back up in a different light to try to win them over. So I can see that happening here, so long as they find a way to make sure that this slips through the cracks somehow, and then all the other developers catch on to it and it becomes a trend.
Right. That was something where I really wanted to talk about. Unfortunately, we're not going to have enough time because Chris said he will be here in just a few minutes, like literally this time. He said solid this time.
Okay.
See what he did there.
We've only got a few minutes before he gets here. But something I really wanted to talk about, and I asked Yong to kind of do some research on it a while ago, was the TPP Act. And it's not the Phantom Pain. It's the Trans-Pacific Party Act, and it has a lot to do with some of the things that you're talking about, where giving like my internet company the ability to say, well, if you want to watch Netflix at 100% streaming speed, you got to pay extra for that. Mm-hmm. And selling like different services through their ISP instead of just here's internet, do what you want. That's a topic for another day, but I think you're absolutely right. I think when a company does something and then ignores what they've done and kind of sweeps it under the rug, it creates a bad issue with that particular game. Now, let me ask you both one quick question. If there was a solution to this, and let's just pretend the solution to pre-order DLC and day one DLC was, you have to pay $10 more for your video game in general. Games said it'd be $59.99, now they're $69.99, but you don't have to deal with, you get everything that would come on a pre-order, you get whatever DLC they were going to make. Would you guys be okay with raising the price of a game to $69.99? Would you pay for it?
Fuck.
No.
That.
No.
Shit.
Absolutely not.
No? You know? You wouldn't?
No.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, I don't
Look, one thing is if, like, would, okay, inflation or something, you know, if that happens and prices need to go up to compensate for inflation in the economy or something like that, that's one
like,
thing.
What,
but to if they can keep the game at $60 and they say, oh, yeah, pay $10 more and get stuff that should be in the game. No, that's just DLC. That's just, you know, a glorified form of DLC. Or
well, that's what I'm saying. Like, let's just pretend that the solution for the problem was you pay $69.99 for a game and they no longer charge for DLC. Like, whatever they make, you get.
Even afterwards?
Yeah.
See, I don't know. That's kind of a toss-up because right now we're at a state now where developers are kind of like, you know what? $59.99 is too low for what we should be charging for games, period. We
I
should be really charging
bullshit.
$80 for games.
That's
to tack
bullshit.
That on top of that, I don't know if I could. I don't think I can still get behind that. I don't think that'll fly for me at all.
I think games are too expensive right now, and I believe the guy over at EA, I forget his name, I believe he's been quoted as saying that games are too expensive right now.
No, in terms of developer standpoint, I get it. Yeah, HD has made games so freaking expensive; it's ridiculous.
Right.
On a consumer standpoint, fuck that. I don't know. I for me, $60 is such a huge investment.
It is.
For one thing that may last, you know, 8 hours, maybe one day, because for some games, other games last forever. And, I don't know. I mean, it's such a, I don't know how much inflation has occurred where $60 is not enough or, you know, I don't know. I'm not a game developer, so I wouldn't know really like how like Phantom Pain was what 80 million dollars
over.
But see,
what?
Even with the $60, if they promote it and advertise it properly, and if people are hyped for it, it'll make back that money like on fucking day one.
Right.
So, like, I don't know. If I knew more about the insides of the gaming industry and how everything works, maybe I could give you a better answer. But on a consumer standpoint, standing here right now, I could not pay $70 for every game. Like, yeah. I could not do that. 50 to $60 for me is a sweet spot.
I think, like I said, I forget the guy's name, but I know for a fact he works for EA. He's the head of EA. And he said that games were too
expensive.
Excuse me?
You're Moore? Like the CEO? Yeah.
I forget his name. I was watching something, a YouTube video about with Jim Sterling.
Because I think I heard about somebody saying that from EA as well. I just can't put my finger on who it was that said it.
They said that games right now are too expensive to, like, for the consumer, not to make, but for the consumer, they shouldn't be $59.99. And then you have EA then you have EA with its Origin service, and everything's $59.99 on there, and it's digital, which is
And that's the thing that pisses me off too, is the whole digital thing. Like, for a while there, developers were trying to justify the $60 price tag as part of that coming from disc printing costs.
Yeah,
but then how does that explain? Printing. Yeah, but then how does that explain the digital side of things, where you're still charging us $60 for those exact same games without the discs?
Bandwidth. Bandwidth. That's what I would yell if I was the PR.
But I mean, for me, I'm just so... Yeah, I do agree that digital versions of the game should be a little less expensive, because the physical copy, I get it. There's a CD, it's like a nice little package, and you're getting like... You're not getting just the game, you're getting like a nice little thing in there, maybe like a poster in there. Sometimes games do that. You're getting like a little mini pamphlet or whatever. And, you know, whatever. But yeah, the digital versions, I mean, you just upload the thing on the net, have people download it, and I mean, it's fairly simple. Like, it saves so much more money. You know, you don't have to do all the production stuff, all the, you know, the factories producing the CDs and the... So, yeah, I mean, I don't know. 50 to 60 for me is the sweet spot. I've gotten so used to the fact that games are $60 that I guess I'm kind of okay with it. Like, I'm not gonna throw a tantrum or anything about a digital game being $60. If they can get that down, though, holy shit. I mean, I think the game industry would benefit from that, because people would purchase more games.
Yeah, yeah. I think so too. I think if games were back where they were, $39.99 for a not, you know, huge AAA, and $49.99 for a regular, you know, like Halo or Metal Gear, that would be that's where I would be comfortable back at. I literally won't pick up some games just because I know that I won't get that much value out of it. Like, for Halo, it was really, really tough for me to get that. The only reason I did is because I couldn't get a review copy of it, because those people are impossible to contact. But if I had my choice, I wouldn't have bought that game, because I had a funny feeling that it was going to be like that. But the last thing that we're going to say before we leave, because Chris is ready to go now.
We've said the last thing like three times.
I know. Well, that's because we kept delaying. There's Chris. Here we go. That is the last thing. How you doing, Chris?
I'm all right. Hi, guys.
All right, we're going to take a real quick commercial break while we get set up with Chris, guys. don't go anywhere. We've got Christopher Randolph coming up for you next.